Okay, just started.
Welcome everybody again. We already had a very informal chat. It's 8 a.m. from Italy. It looks like the weather news here. And today we are going for the session two of this very short course. If you were thinking about seeing formulas and tricks about quick design, it's not going to happen in 9 hours. But this is going to be basically the top of the iceberg. We are going to give you a very fast, quick overview about the latest developments, not only the oldest, 20 years ago. And then we're going to provide materials, so reading materials for all of you to investigate, go deep as you prefer. Obviously, in the list of references of every paper, we will not be overwhelming with 100 papers, but maybe with a selection of 10 to 20. And so you can see from out of those 2020 whether you like more the numerical part, the analytical part, the application part, so the discussion of real world in implementation in buildings, because people still believe that this is theory. Instead, it's actually practice of becoming theory in a way, so powerful the technology is, and so forth. So let me go to the presentation. And I'm sharing my screen. So I will share my own screen just to make sure when I do the... Hold on a second. There you are. It's coming. Okay, you should be able to see the slides, don't you? First of all, I didn't mention, but this first slide is a bit shocking because it represents on the top the skyline and the mountains behind the city of Christchurch before the earthquake, and then it shows the photo picture, private people taking picture from the port hills, from the hills, and seeing the city during the shaking. So what you see on the bottom is not pollution, it's actually the debris of a city that falls. There's been also a title of a movie. So it's quite shocking, and I wish you to think about the reality if you had the luck not to live in such an experience, because it's a matter of wishing the worst enemy not to be there. If you had the luck not to be there, remember that when you're working on research, you're working for something real. And it's very complicated, especially when you're a younger age. Excuse me if I use a little bit of the I can't even say the gray air. It's the no air. I had a lot of air before the earthquake, and the stress made a change in the body, but we went through. It's important that when you're thinking about bond, when you're thinking about tower sleep, when you're thinking about beam column joints, when you're thinking about pushover time history, you think that you are trying to do something in this space, which is a city that falls, people that dies, people that are destroying their life. For how much it looks like rhetoric, that's exactly why we are raising the bar. We are pushing towards ultimate earthquake proof, because not only this should not happen, but this is not what people think should happen. So we go through and we are thinking about, again, international part of the world. Everywhere in the world, we are in the same situation. And again, the argument is, and I understand it is, that you would be in a country where the existing stock is extremely vulnerable because it's very old, because it's, but that's one part of the truth. The second part of the truth is that from tomorrow, you are designing a new building, and so you should not use a 1980 type of technology. From tomorrow, you're retrofitting an existing building, so you should do your best to use the new technology for new design. We're going to see that. The new technology for new design adapted for retrofitting existing buildings. So go fast and quick. We discussed about the shaking. We discussed about the impracticality, the uncertainty of the demand. If you wish, very often, I go faster to the February 22nd February 2011. If you wish, you know that there is a, as a researcher, you would know, there is a humongous amount of debate and open topic on evaluating uncertainties using beta, using a probabilistic approach, using reliability. Is nothing bad. It's actually a good way of using math to try to quantify something. But remember again the bottom line. It really doesn't matter if you have a 70%, 80%, or 85%, 90% of protection thanks to the vaccine in a pandemic situation. It doesn't matter if you have a probability of exceedance of a certain number. What matters is when that scenario occurs and you don't have any protection. So what we try to do is to try to design for something which is not a bunker, is not a nuclear power plant, it should remain a house. It should remain so cost affordable, but with the robustness to receive, remember the concept of robustness is very clear. If I get something as an input, I don't have to explode the input in my, let's call it transverse function, if you wish, in my box of a building. A mistake in the input should not become even bigger as an output. So something different in terms of spectral ordinates, something different in terms of shaking level should not collapse my building. Although that's something different is higher than the design level, excuse me, earthquake. So I want you to focus on this. Uncertainties in the design is absolutely part of the deal. When you make the uncertainty becoming deterministic, so you think about one or two scenarios, and unfortunately or fortunately, the Canterbury earthquake have given to us many scenarios because there've been different type of aftershock coming from different direction, a different type of somehow fault rupture, same type of local soil conditions with a very specific site amplification effects. But we absolutely need to recall that the risk given by hazard on one hand and vulnerability can be controlled by working on the vulnerability. So we are going back to the earthquake does not read the code. You are a box on the ring, and as a box on the ring, you have to be prepared to sustain different punches. And we go. We understood what happened. We understood that pre-760 and 80 buildings, not necessarily 22 story, might go in trouble. But the big surprise, and that's exactly the starting point again, is the behavior, the plastic hinge, ductile type of behavior, typical of a cast in situ technology, can be typical of a weld of a steel, either welded or bolted connection where you are using the flange for plastic behavior. And that's exactly the plastic hinge. Why I went back to this recap, because I want to show you the video. There you are. It should be working now. There you are. That's what we were able to do and what we were able to do already. We were able to do well before the earthquake in terms of numerical modeling, and now we are able to do even faster. So just imagine that you were going to your client and you were explaining that, by the way, I'm going to design a fantastic 22-story building, which will cost approximately $80 million New Zealand dollars, approximately, this type of building. I will be receiving a proper fee as part of my design. I don't want to go to the percentage depending on different countries, but we are talking about a significant fees because it's a big, big structure. It is a 2021 type of structure. It's going to have a precast emulative detailing, and you're going to explain to your client, by the way, it's important that you need to know, I'm designing for, in the performance matrix, I'm designing for this point, which is the minimum by law, and you're going to say it's going to be the minimum by law. This point means that when the earthquake will come, this is exactly what you're going to see in your living room and in your best meeting room with the CEO and all the international patrons that are coming to your office. And if it's not clear enough, that's exactly what it will look like in a fast speed during the earthquake. You're going to have a bit of pieces falling down on the desk, nothing to worry about. You're going to be absolutely scared, but you're going to get out of the building because I will be designing your stairs, not in the old fashioned 1980, not even in the new, yet a bit old fashioned that was used in New Zealand, which was absolutely amazing, using a sort of a base isolation concept where the stair flights are connected on the top and are sliding on the bottom between two stories. It was already a huge improvement, yet it was not sufficient because some of the detailing had to be improved. I don't have the time to go through that, but please check it. The stairs in a building should be the egress, the safety egress of people. If we don't design the stairs in a different way from what we typically do today, what you will get is people trapped in a building with a huge concern and fear to have to be trapped with a fire after an earthquake, which is unfortunately is very common to happen. So if you go to the internet today, I wanted to do a little bit of interaction, and maybe I will do it. And you look at for Forth Site Bar. Forth Site Bar is a building in New Zealand where when the stairs collapsed, people were so concerned about having a fire after the earthquake that they started descending themselves using a fire hose to evacuate through the windows. Just to tell you the how scared you can become and how much for survival reason you're going to go through. So what is our target? Our target obviously is to avoid a modern country, well advanced in seismic engineering, well aware about the consequence of earthquakes. So you cannot talk about ignorance of people, you cannot talk about ignorance of codes, you cannot talk about a lack of implementation of good detailing and good design being completely demolished. So we discussed about that, the consequence of it is not only, which is already the top priority, the number of fatalities, but it is even more than that, which it would be already enough to have a significant number of fatalities. And just for the statistics, remember the earthquake in Christchurch, the sequence should have statistically, if we look at the mean or the median, that 7.1 magnitude and the 6.2 as an aftershock should have had thousands of victims. If it was a different construction type, if it was a different, let's say, country environment. So the 185 fatalities somehow should be read in terms of thousands have been saved by good design or by design according to the capacity design principles, but also 40 billion New Zealand dollars means 25% of GDP, which have been affecting, which would have affected the whole economy for a while. Why did not affect in a similar way from an economical point of view only? Because of this private and public insurance scheme, EQC, Earthquake Commission, go and please and check it, because it's the only reason for which New Zealand did not shut down the doors and go bankrupt. Thanks to a cash flow coming into the country, you ask the Arsalan of the time, the consulting office in New Zealand couldn't be any busier. They're being challenged with the design and construction of an entire city, basically. In addition to the job that was happening already before, so in addition to the whole country developing with new infrastructure being requested and new places and new immigration coming in, 2002 when I went there, the population was 3,200,000. In now 20 years later is 4 million. So just imagine any country where you're living that in 20 years, an increase of 30% of inhabitants is humongous. It's not 30, it's 25, but it's absolutely humongous. So in such a booming economy, there is a need and a not only an opportunity, but a need to do a next step up. So to raise the bar and designing according to safer and resilient, which is not a code based because the code did not change. The code is still telling you life safety is the minimum. So also the code is not even introducing the concept of resilience, but everyone is talking about that and the ministries are talking about that and so forth. So go fast and quick. We want to get out of this, if you want, conceptual trap. This is a great way to save people. It's not sufficient enough to save the building. And if you're not saving the building, you're not saving the day life from both a comfort point of view and from both technical working point of view. So we discussed about that and we discussed about the performance matrix. I will give you some updates, material on performance metrics. We are not using anymore, although it's in the code, only maximum drift as a performance indicator, so EDP, engineering demand parameters, but we're using also residual drift. So the capacity of a building to go back to the original position, it's an important parameter as much as the maximum drift. So I will give you some references, 2006, to a probabilistic approach for including a maximum and residual drift in one matrix, and so designing a structure which could recenter, not only that could reach a maximum drift of 4%, but could also recenter back. Go back, go back, go back. There you are. That's our target. So this is not only conceptual. If the requirement is to stay within a repairable condition, your challenge should be to try to demonstrate with your math, with your mathematics, with a loss modeling, that you could actually, within a certain time frame, in wartime, you're going to be in wartime. It's not peacetime. So resources will not be available. Everyone will be asking for the same resources. So obviously you need to minimize the number of operations for repairing your structure to get back to operational. But the bottom line is that we want to do something where at quite a big level of earthquake, literally has nothing to do. The nothing to do is I could just show you, just looking you into your room, you might have some cracks here and there that you never bother to fix. That's the level. We should be thinking about our next level of next generation of buildings where under a good shaking, which enforce you to hold yourself on your desk, just to give an idea, or suggest you to go under the desk. You raise up, you check around, everything is fine, some cracks here and there, you keep going. And this is exactly the experience of the, when we are going to show you one of the Pressland buildings in the University of Canterbury campus. That's exactly the narrative of the CEO of the research project who was in the building when it was shaking. And basically after that, he just got back to his desk. And they went to call him to say, get out, I'm fine. No, you are fine, but the buildings around are not. So you get out because things have gone badly, badly wrong. So this is supposed to be a perception. And I remember we were in 2000, and I have to think about 2010 probably. It was really the Macedonian earthquake engineering conference, European conference in earthquake engineering. So really one day before the earthquake in New Zealand, where I had an invited lecture, and I was speaking about this next level up of an earthquake, is not an earthquake proof, but a low damage earthquake resistant building towards an earthquake proof. And people were thinking it makes sense. The analogy that I made is rain, not hurricane, but rain and storm, very heavy storm. And I was saying, people should be thinking that an earthquake, as it is part of the nature. Just recently, they've been given a splendid, on television, informative a session on television about the Campanile grade, the volcanic activities in Italy. To explain that there are volcanoes in the depth of the ocean, as well as underneath the city of Naples, because everyone will know the typical big volcanoes, the Etna, which is very very active, and the volcano in Naples, which is the Vesuvio, who's silent and very active once after a while. I mean, to cut it short, it's a matter of informing, explaining, discussing people. It's a matter of hazard. So should we understand that our challenge is to have a natural hazard event, like a big storm. And after that big storm, people living in a house, not in a grotto anymore, should not risk their life. In addition to that, they should be continuing going. Now let's go and see what we have. And this is changing. So the base isolation of the past has already changed when compared to what we had. And it's not only changing because of the devices, just be very, very, very careful on that. A device doesn't make the system low damage. And I have to stress it because there is a little bit of a misunderstanding from the population. Population thinks that if I buy this viscous damper or shape memory alloys and I place into my building, basically, I don't know what they think. Basically, there is a sort of a bubble protection, you know, sort of a like when you're in a Star Wars sort of environment, which is protecting me from the earthquake. The design is a low damage design. And obviously, if you try to make a low damage design and use a different technology, it's going to be easier. But if you want to make a low damage design out of unreinforced masonry buildings, you can do it. It's a matter of knowing how. It's a matter of knowing how you basically activate the rocking of that wall without activating the shear failure of the spandrel beam. So it's really a matter of understanding what mechanism we could use and how to take advantage of it. Obviously, in an engineering concept, every single movement relatively to one element to the other can be sliding, can be rocking, can be flexure, can be shear. We want to take advantage by using a device which will be taking not only energy harvesting, but really literally taking away and throwing away the energy from the earthquake. So that's a different concept. So I will be using relative motion to activate energy dissipators such that while my motion is by definition trying to escape the building punch, because if I don't move, I break in elastofragic, but if I move, I'm able to change with my kinematic, I'm able to change the input energy into something which is not a damageable type of energy, kinematic. Then while I'm doing a kinematic type of input transformation from the input energy, I will try to take advantage of some hysteretic type of damping coming from devices. And so very important, a low damage design requires a designer, which is different than saying the low damage design requires a dissipator. Forget about that. You could use a beautiful viscous damping, the shape memory alloys, but if the design is not appropriate, you might fall into the trap of having a soft story mechanism. And this is absurd, but it's absolutely true. So what happened since that? We go back and we see that this is Sparta. Obviously, you know what I'm talking about. And in Greece, Sparta, Athens, they were fighting against each other, and the earthquake was not part of the problem. It was part of life. And while they were fighting to have the power on the in the Greek time on the whole peninsula, they were dealing with earthquakes and they were managing to come out with solutions. And if we go back now to see what solution they've been used, interestingly enough, we did not go back and took ideas. We thought we discovered something incredibly smart, and then we look at in the past and think, oh my gosh, do you really mean that they already knew it? So it's interesting, which is a suggestion. In the past, I had a request for a special sabbatical. I didn't manage to do it. And my special sabbatical was meant to go in some archives, in some libraries, typically in Italy, because at least I could read Latin and could read ancient Greek, to be able to find the descriptions of technologies that we could use for seismic resistance. It did not happen. We were too busy, so never managed to do that. So I will do in my fourth part of my career, when I will be 120, 130 years old, I will be taking that time off. So think from that point of view, earthquakes is not something that we invented, obviously. People had to deal with that. And look at this temple of Diana, Artemis in Ephesus. You might know about that. Pliny the Elder in the Natural Historia. This is obviously a translation in broken English. It was mentioned that this building was built on marshy soil, locating charcoal. Charcoal means sphere. Don't think about barbecues, think sphere. And wool first means a slider. They already had created a slider under its foundation to reduce the sensitivity of the building to the earthquake and to avoid locating such a big mass on unstable soil. Basically, they had already found a way to create what a few years later we rediscovered. And interesting enough, the first question mark, but it's the first evidence of a patent on Bayes' isolation. When I'm in New Zealand, I made a joke. I say, unfortunately, it's not been invented by New Zealand. To be honest, not even being invented by the Italians. This is the first patent on Bayes' isolation. Viscardini in Italy created and deposited a patent after a major earthquake that we had in southern Italy. But I still have with me, and so I'm happy that Arsalan is here and also Niku, my great Iranian former PhD students. When I was time to leave from New Zealand, I still have quite a small sculpture, if you wish, because they remind me, don't keep talking about the Greek temples. In Persia, we had done it earlier on. So it's absolutely brilliant. If you go and see in India, and so you start going back really, in China, in Persia, in Greece, which for us is the Mediterranean country, you find example of rocks onto rocks which are sliding. You find example in the Greek temples, they managed to find evidences of basically the use of softer soil on the top of stiff soil, a softer soil, like if it was a pool, a swimming pool, created to enforce an isolation. So if you make a softer soil on the top of a strong soil, you will think that you're going to amplify. True, but at the same time, you're going to cut the acceleration coming in. So in a way, this concept of a slider that we had, and of course became the friction pendulum, you know that when you call it a friction pendulum system is actually a commercial name, we are using it, but we should be calling a slider with a concave, one or two surfaces or three surfaces. Plenty of that had been used, but also literally this is the true best, most revolutionary device, the lead rubber bearing, which created in New Zealand by Bill Robinson, Ivan Skinner, and McVary. Bill Robinson, PhD in mechanical engineering, he thought about the lead. Ivan Skinner, a brilliant designer, who was designing, for example, the stepping bridge, a rocking bridge with a viscous damper on the bottom. It's a railway bridge in New Zealand, and many other things, including, I will show you later on, the U-shaped flexure plate. He developed those. Basically, the combination of lead, which is dissipating a lot, and laminated rubber became the device that made Bayes' isolation in the late 70s and then 80s, really taking a boom in terms of usage all around the world. Interesting enough, very recently, when I'm explaining this type of things, let me take the light down. When I'm explaining this type of things, the very much frequently asked question connecting the earthquake in Christchurch and the Bill Robinson, Ivan Skinner of the kind is, where can we find the instrumentation of the Bayes' isolated buildings? It's embarrassing. It's an embarrassing question. We got a workshop after the earthquake with the Japanese team, and they were asking, so let's share the information. Can you share the information of the many isolated buildings with the instrumentation on? And the problem were twofold. First, in Christchurch, we only had one Bayes-isolated buildings, which is the Christchurch Women's Hospital, 2007 approximately designed, 2005-2007, only one. Second, it was not instrumented. Third, what about the other buildings being instrumented? And we were just looking around. You know, when you're young and they're asking you a question, you don't want to be interviewed by the teacher. So the same thing. After the 2010 earthquake, we had to wait for the 2011 earthquake. We have to wait for the 2012 replica. We have to wait for a number of years. And eventually, base isolation is coming up, including other type of devices, backing restraint braces I mentioned to you, viscous dampers, and so many other technology, including rocking dissipative, which are happening. How many buildings are being instrumented? You would say, for sure, every new building is being instrumented. Not yet. There was a discussion. There was actually also some messages going to the media to try to promote the mandatory usage with a financial incentives of instrumentation. So again, this might be a challenge for you people. Try to convince your client with that with a few thousand dollars. It's part of the deal. It will be coming at the end of the slides. It's part of the deal to know the basics of your car, the fuel, the pressure in the wheels, the water, the oil conditions. You have the basics, but the car will have a sort of a hard drive whereby when you go to a mechanic workshop, they will be able to know everything about your car in terms of health monitoring. So if we are doing that for a car, which has a cost of, say, a few thousand dollars, say, $10,000, $20,000, why don't we do it for a $80 million building? And you will be wondering, oh, fair enough, for the big buildings we will be doing, it's not happening. But for sure, we'll be doing for every house about, I don't know, $500,000, which is 50 times a car. No, we don't do it. Why? The perception is it's not worth. And then when we get an earthquake, we are actually sending search and rescue people without having a digital drawing or if you wish, you could have a virtual reality glasses to see what type of structural system is behind where you're going to be sure that you are walking in a safe path within the building. And you should have a recorded drift. Every search and rescue engineer, depending on the drift, depending on the structural system that they can see through, they will be able to assess the damage and the safety much faster. It's not science fiction. It's easily doable if we agree that it's going to become doable. So you think, you see that the idea of next generation of buildings is more than the structural skeleton. It's about the culture that is required to be behind all of this. So let's go back to see, again, the legacy, because from this charcoal with the slider, the most evident earthquake-resistant solution that we have been inheriting from the past, and I'm using what I know and what I studied, but you literally go everywhere in the world and you find minarets, or you find different type of temples which are using what they could. And what they could was rocking of marble blocks or a stone block on the top of another marble blocks, including capitals on the top and basement on the bottom. What are the capitals doing? For sure, they were distributing the load. So they are actually working we are studying and we are still studying. I don't know how much is going to continue. We are studying punching shear. And you're wondering why you're studying punching shear instead of solving the punching shear? Because we are still designing, avoiding sometimes capitals. And there's been, for example, a failure of a car parking at Smith City in Christchurch, which was a flat slab with columns without a proper capitals. And so there was a punching shear. It's incredible that we already know what we should be doing. But from an architectural point of view, sometimes we take away detailing just because we think it's too much. So they were already doing something to distribute the loading. But if you think in a proper way, and literally we discover that by trying to create a rocking building in reality, where the wall was too long, the architect was not happy, we had to make the wall shrinking, but we were losing lever arm. So we thought about a brilliant idea, which was already here, but we didn't know. The brilliant idea is, but if I shrink the web of the wall, and then at the base, I just enlarge it. As soon as I saw it, I say, oh my gosh, this is the basement of a rocking temple. They had a column, and then they enlarged the basement to be able to give more lever arm to the rocking motion. Absolutely brilliant. So my suggestion, if it's not clear enough, is sometimes let's go back and literally go to archaeological sites and try to understand why and what that was in such a way, because we will be literally understanding a lot. This comes from my laureate thesis. So we were looking at, it's coming, doesn't mean that I did, this picture comes because I was working on the Leaning Tower of Pisa. I had a pleasure to work on the Leaning Tower with the Professor Giorgio Macchi. who was with Jamolkowski from Turin Geotechnical, and with Fritz Leonhardt, professor from Stuttgart, was taking care of delivering the Tower of Pisa to the next generation. And so the Tower of Pisa is basically a rocking structure. That's where my rocking investigation started from. So we were working on the concept. I don't have here the picture of the tower. I should be pulling off. But you can find here, if you go to Science Learn, something very interesting. I put a link. In New Zealand, they organized a very interesting program on the web for, I say kids, they're not really kids. They are boys and girls at high school level, but also at intermediate school level. So let's say between grade 6 and grade, year 11, year 18, just to give an idea. But it can be also done for primary school. And so the idea was to explain what is earthquake engineering, how can we learn from the past. Go there. First of all, you'll be smiling. I don't. It's the same type of smile, but you'll be smiling seeing someone who looks like my son. It's me, younger. But that younger before the earthquake, which tells you what the earthquake did. So it was not many years before and not many years after. But basically, it's really about taking that, going to the analytical concept of rocking, exploring the rocking from a mathematical point of view. And there is a theory of the rigid body rocking motion from George Hausner, Professor Hausner, who developed a very interesting theory who went for decades, and we've been using it, whereby the rigid block rocks on the pivots. What we had to do when it was time to develop the new generation of something more in modern time, of the Greek temples, if you wish, of the Persian monuments or something else. We are in 1990s, and there's a huge project being developed by the Precast Concrete Institute, PCI. The concrete, precast concrete was suffering in the market. It was basically about multi-story building becoming in seismic regions like California, becoming more steel material. Precast concrete was being put on the side because there was a bit of a, in a way, lack of information about precast and pre-stressed concrete in seismic areas. There was also a prejudice against precast pre-stressed being seen as a problem. So the concept was some car parking, 1994 Northridge collapsed. But if you go to in China in the 70s, there were problems. And so the idea, instead of being detailing was the problem, we need to fix the detailing, because the unseating of an hollow core is not due to the material, it's due to detailing. If you don't put a proper length of seating length, it's not a matter of concrete or steel or timber or masonry, it's a matter of detailing. So the prejudice was pushing precast away. So there's again, I like to think about that we are learning from the past. Good positive actions from the industry. Option one, you reduce the price, you try to be competitive as much as you can, you go down to cost, raw cost, and you try to force your technology into the market by cost. Option two, you spend money. So what do you mean? You invest, you create a new system, and you go to the next level up. So it's interesting because to get out of troubles, including or in a recession time, the best way to save yourself is to invest. And few people in the past have the I'm recorded, so I shouldn't say the guts, so I will not be saying that, have the courage. A participant requested live transcription being able for the meeting. Live transcription, we try. But it's impossible. I mean, we can try, but let me see. Not bad. Okay, I'm trying. Not bad, he's talking about my bed, okay. I don't know if you see the live transcription there, it's quite annoying, but I will try to go slowly. So I understand that the participant is asking to go slowly because your broken English looks like too much Italian. Italian, not Kit Highland. Okay, it's fantastic. Okay, apart from that, are you able now to see the live transcription or it's only me?
I just switched it on. It's interesting, but
it's very interesting. Now you see, who was Andrea? You were speaking.
I was. I don't know what.
So your translation was correct. Is my broken English very bad?
Okay. I'm used to Italian English, so I'm good.
Okay, so I'll be slowing down and try to mumble less and less. So bottom line, PCI invest a lot and they created a new project. It's called US, actually it was a US-Japan collaboration. And in that collaboration, they pushed for different type of solution, including precast. So the solution or the project for precast was called press. We call this press technology, and some people don't even know where it comes from. It comes from precast seismic structural system. It's a project in the United States with many universities, coordinated by University of California, San Diego, principal investigator Nigel Priestley. So we're talking about the Park and Poly Priestley. That Priestley that you have been hearing about, young lecturer, senior lecturer at Canterbury, and then director of a lab in New Zealand, was literally hired, by University of California, San Diego to go for the next level up. At that time, Berkeley was the golden university in seismic engineering. San Diego wanted to go to that level, and Nigel Priestley managed to make it happen. In the 90s, the project of PRESS was really about finding something different. And interesting enough, that something different is on the insides. It was not coming because of the Greek temples. It was now, we read that on the insides, was let's take a dry connection. The development came up with a dry precast elements connected by post-tensioning, the trick being that the post-tensioning is not only bonded, it's not anymore bonded, so it's not grouted with the corrugated metallic ducts in order to have bond between steel and concrete, but it's unbonded. Unbonded means that you can slide through. So you still grout, but you're using a PVC or a smooth duct such that when you're opening, when you're rocking back and forth, the concept is really rocking, this post-tensioning is sliding through, which means it remains elastic, like a spring. It's an elastic bungee jump. It's a spring. So you're pushing your building back and forth, and you're literally are going to activate your tendons, your spring, which is going to recenter. So we call it from rocking, from pure rocking, which is basically the effect of an element moving back and forth. If you put a spring vertical or horizontal to connect the elements, you're able to control the rocking. Reason being is that in a rocking system, the force displacement, when you go above the pivot point, or when you go above the equilibrium point, it's not anymore the pivot, then you go for negative stiffness. So basically, you collapse. A rocking system will have a almost rigid initial stiffness and then a softening. A control rocking will always have a post-yielding, a post-rocking, positive stiffness, because the post-tensioning, horizontal or vertical, is coaxial. So think about a vertical wall, you can see on the right-hand side, there's no P delta, because the axial load here, the post-tensioning, is working coaxially with your structure. So basically, excuse me a second, basically, you're able all the time, the more you move, the more you charge the post-tensioning tendon. So the concept became to put together what is called a hybrid system, which is made of two types of steel. There is a post-tensioning, giving you unbonded post-tensioning, giving you recentering, and mild steel, providing you the typical plastic hinge dissipation capacity, but it's not in the form of the plastic hinge. So if the plastic hinge worked like that, and this is a nice sketch of Dion Marriott, one of the first PhD in Canterbury, working with myself and Alessandro Palermo on that. So you get damage. So tension on one side and compression on the other, obviously. And then you flip through tension, compression. The hysteresis loop it's not an elastoplastic, it's a stiffness degrading. So you can call it Takeda. Typically speaking, you lose stiffness. You lose stiffness because cracks means losing stiffness, because you break the bond in between. When you switch to the new generation, and I like to call it the new temple, the new ancient temple, so I don't mention any more Greek, it's just for equal condition. for equality, the new generation of rocking ancient structures became something like that. In between, what you don't see, it's a cable which will be running all the way through. And the more you lift, the more the cable will spring you back. And this stenosis loop is dissipative and recentering. The name is flag shape, looks like a flag. And it's actually a very special type of hysteresis, which will provide you dissipation, because once you rock, you're going to have the same type of, let's say, steel bars dissipating energy or something different, which we're going to see. But at the same time, you're able to bring it back. Very often we were using in the past in the conferences, then we stopped, thinking that people would have got bored by the same jokes. We were using those giraffes, those toys with the giraffes that you're made of timber with a spring, with a jump bungee inside, elastic bungee. And we were pushing and this animal, toy animal, is actually coming back. So it's the same basically concept. So think about the boxer. You receive a punch. You are going to receive the punch by transforming the energy into kinetic energy, so you are moving. But the more you move, the more you're charging yourself, and you're coming back. So basically, you keep coming back to the original position. Where is the damage? It's not a no damage. Very important. We are not talking about free damage. Damage free. Some people, for research point of view, have been using a free damage, which is an interesting, it's appealing. But let's not communicate wrongly to the people. This was the damage at the end of which earthquake we would be having a residual deformation, permanent deformation. So this is part of a big deal. There is a building in New Zealand made of steel, C1 Tower, new building. If people go and ask what was the problem with that building, basically there was very few damage, partly in the braces. Partly, so you already understand, if I say damaging braces means plastic behavior, means non-recoverable residual permanent deformation. There were problems of facades. The facades were, again, dislocated and had to be fixed, and the detailing for two refixing is quite important. More importantly, the lift shaft was not straight enough, because the residual drift was actually true and real. So if you get this residual drift in a structure, then you have to bring back the structure straight, and the lift shaft is the first thing that will not be working because it's not able to go safely all the way up, all the way down. So we have been discovering that in a new community, in a modern seismic country, in a modern building, then the problem is not anymore like safety, becomes everything else. So if you go to that type of solution, the rocking of the temple, then if you are able to do this, basically you are concentrating the damage where the plastic cage doesn't exist anymore. Or it does exist, but it's not anymore plastic. It's actually air opening and closing. So basically by opening and closing air, which means no damage, you get the same type of response. The displacement will not be any longer, any bigger, because you're going to design for displacement-based design. What is going to localize the damage depends on your device. So if you're using, and here we are, if you're using a typical internal rebars, so if you're going back to the reinforced concrete rebars, dissipating energy, yielding back and forth, and they stay inside, obviously they are localizing the damage. And after the earthquake, you would have never, after the earthquake, thought about how to replace the rebar here. You would have never thought in a plastic hinge to replace the rebar. You would have thought about replacing the concrete cover. But suddenly, as soon as people see this new solution, they think about, how can then I replace the rebar? Because you are explaining to them that the only damage is in the rebar. And then suddenly people are becoming, my joke is, greedy. Until yesterday, you were happy with a building which was damaged in local position, possibly not repairable, possible also deformed, such that you should have pushed your neighbor building. Imagine asking your neighbor, would you mind if I put a couple of actuators just to push your building because I need to straighten myself up? And your neighbor would be absolutely not a problem. But then they will remember Force and reaction basics studied at intermediate school, because it's a mandatory school, it's involved or not. Action reaction means that you push yourself, I receive the same force, means that I get damaged. Yes, but we spread the uncomfort. So it would be nice between neighbors. So it's not like offering a pizza to your neighbor. So in a building, this problem, perimeter deformation, in a building is already complicated. And is hugely complicated. Who really put the practicality of this complication of residual or permanent deformation into after an earthquake were the Japanese. We are talking about Kawashima. We are talking about Kobe earthquake 1995. They discovered that bridge piers, typically made of L shape, the one that went in trouble were the non-symmetric ones. So pier with a cap beam being a L shape. You can imagine that with the mass, this type of response becomes a ratcheting response. So ratcheting means you're going back and forth, typically pushing in one direction. It's like taking a punch, not being able to go up, taking another punch. So you're basically accumulating damage in one direction, which means that you're not going to recenter. So there was bridges, thousands of piers, which required to be demolished and reconstructed because the residual or permanent drift was higher than 1%. And higher than 1%, if you look at the hysteresis loop that we are using, which is a fat Takeda, it's not an elastoplastic, but it's not far away. The static residual when compared to the maximum drift is approximately 50%. So which means that if you design for 2% of drift, your static residual is in the about of 0.8%, 1%, 0.8%. The dynamic residual helps you because the dynamic, the small cycle are going to recenter back. But then you get hit again by the aftershock and you start from a residual deformation. So when you run an aftershock in your numerical analysis, by definition, you're running an earthquake, you leave a lot of zeros for enough length to allow for the free oscillation, and then you run the aftershock. If you go and check after the free oscillation, what is the starting point of your structure, the structure starts from a residual. And so depending on the positive or negative, this is one of the first condition where it's important to have a plus or minus in the earthquake accelerogram. So if you are pushing in one direction with the cycle going into the ratcheting direction, or you're actually trying to correct, you're getting a different answer. So it's not the same thing running a plus or a minus an accelerogram when you have obviously a non-symmetric anymore structure, okay? So sometimes for some of you, I'm going to some detailing and I know that some of you can follow very easily. Some of other participants are working on maybe on geotechnical non-earthquake engineering, so they might be having a little bit more trouble. Okay, so we get, that's it, low damage type of solution, which means that eventually we're able to make a paradigm shift. What is the paradigm shift? It's changing the way of thinking of plastic engines. This slide I've been using in 2012, I will be giving you the paper of the keynote lecture I had the honor to be invited to give at the World Conference in Earthquake Engineering 2012. We were in Lisbon, as Andre Barbosa very proudly would remember. So Lisbon organized the World Conference of Earthquake Engineering, which for the non-academic is something happening every 4 years and moving around the world. And 2012 means fresh, unfortunately, after the 2010-11 Canterbury earthquake. So I've been asked to provide a keynote which could look at the future, not at what happened in Christchurch. And so we were already pushing for the future before the earthquake as part of research. It's a matter of letting people know that we were already developing and implementing buildings of low damage prior to the earthquake. We did not have to wait for the earthquake in Christchurch to have the right motivation. The earthquake in Christchurch convinced people about the need to embrace this new technology, if you wish. So 1960, the revolution in earthquake engineering has been to go from a soft story type of mechanism, weak columns and strong beam, to a beam sway mechanism. Plastic hinges for me where I want, ductile detailing in the plastic hinge to be able to allow the plastic hinge to plasticize. And that has made the revolution from collapse to life safety. So from here, from 1960 onwards or 1970, whenever the courts around the world adopted this concept, allowed to move from one very important level up of performance, collapse to life safety. When we go to low damage, some people, it's a matter of knowing and not knowing the detailing, thought that this was the end of capacity design. I got upset because they were trying to have me to say, and I had Nigel Priestley as a PhD supervisor, it's not that you get, you don't get brainwashed. It's the other way around. You try to think in a different way. Having met Professor Park and Pauli in New Zealand, you see how they were thinking, how they managed to go to that point. Is capacity design going to throw away? Absolutely not. Capacity design is still the most fundamental concept that we have. It's still saying weakest link of the chain. Capacity design, with the technology available in the 1960s and 70s, had to imply that ductility created in the weakest link means damage. Because if you only have a technology, a cast in situ type of concrete, a steel connection which is going to have a flange plasticizing, of course, the weakest link will lead to damage. But now we have a possibility of saying that the ductility in a low damage solution doesn't require to be equal to damage anymore. So basically, we are breaking the most important, not concept of capacity design, but the most important consequence associated with technology. So is capacity design still valid? Absolutely, yes. You are going to start designing your structure with all weakest, less weak, stronger, protected. The foundation will be overprotected, or if you look at the latest development with Professor Gazzetta pushing for a little bit of helping on inner range of the foundation. So it's all about deciding the distance between capacity design in a sequence of events, and then making the weakest link low damage. The weakest link that you are is going to be, I'm going to show you the next slide, is going to be something different. So what are the milestones in earthquake engineering? We went through all of that. These are beam column joints. I don't know if there are some of the participants belonging to this cohort of students. Hold on a second. There you are. These are beam column joints that we were casting, designing, casting, and testing as part of an undergraduate structural concrete course at Canterbury University. So just to understand why, when I mentioned that if you went through that type of path, including the PhD, you should have been very amazing, because it has been quite a challenge. So imagine a structural concrete 101, it's a 300 level. So we're talking about a third year of undergrad out of a four year. And basically we are challenging the student to do their own construction of the cage, bending the steel, casting the concrete, doing the concrete mix design, designing the beam column joint. The setup was already in the lab, but the beam column joint detailing to be able to take it. And we go into the lab and we test, we make the class testing. So undergraduate class testing, a pre-70 beam column joint with no stirrups in the joint and weak link in the joint. A post-70, see here 2004, we are using NZS, New Zealand Standard 3101, which is the concrete code. The concrete code was changing. We had a new version 2006. So we were already giving the draft to the students. We are able to go to this 4% of drift with a beautiful plastic hinge where the concrete is falling and as is supposed to be part of the deal. And then another group is working on the next generation of code, which it was drafted. So basically the students helped debugging literally, the writing up of the Appendix B of the Concrete Society Code, New Zealand Standard 3101 2006, where we were discussing about hybrid system jointed ductile connection. And so they developed their own test in the lab. The students developed their beams, the columns with a grout pad, and they were able to see, I don't know now if you can actually see everything, I get the transcripts in front of me. They were able to see the rocking happening, no damage whatsoever, apart from, obviously, building of the rebars. If a student from undergrad is able to do all of that, we have a done deal. Basically, we have managed to get to a simplification of a theoretically complex technology into a real life. If you were asking to these students, what would you prefer to get as a question? You don't ask what would you like to design in the future. Is surviving time. We are going to have a written exam. I'm going to give you a question. And the question would be to design a plastic hinge for calculating the moment curvature for cast in situ technology, or design and calculate the moment rotation for a rocking system. You bet they were all choosing this. Why? Because this can be done on a half a page. And the confirmation is that if I ask every one of you right now to give me 3 seconds, I give you 5 seconds, I give you 30 seconds, an answer of how much curvature do you see here, you will have to calculate that. You don't see the curvature. The curvature is not something that you can visualize. If I can ask you what is the rotation, you will take your ruler saying displacement divided by height, I tell you the radians. So we understand rotation because we can see. It's like asking to you how much is your weight in kgs or how much is your weight in megapascal. Same thing. You know by heart what is in the kg. You can't see the force, but you can see displacement. You can see rotation. Similarly, it's very much more complicated to derive the pressure, the megapascal. So from a design point of view, basically the idea is going back to the simplicity of the temples in the past, in enhancing them, improving them with the post-tensioning tendons coming from the bridge or coming from the building concepts, and adding steel, but nothing complicated at the beginning. It was just the typical steel used for reinforced concrete, which obviously the temple in the past could not have. Basically, you're creating a new generation of those type of earthquake resisting system, which work very well. What is the next step up? And so it's 9, 10, and in 5 minutes, I will have a break, okay? We are going to have a break. Is to make the weakest link that should be ductile repairable. So the next step up has been to work on the tiny problem of reinforced concrete still having rebars inside. And so the question is why, in order to literally change the way of thinking, we should be asking to ourselves always a question which looks so obvious, but then the answer is giving us the suggestion. Why reinforced concrete has steel inside? In steel inside what? That's the point. Steel inside the cover concrete. Why the cover concrete is cover concrete? And so the answer became that the cover concrete is therefore prejudice to avoid the steel to buckle. No. The cover concrete is not there for avoiding steel to buckle. The steel is not buckling because of the transverse reinforcement. Okay, so what is the cover concrete there for? It's to take compression. Forget about that. If you have enough section, it's not certainly the D prime of the cover concrete helping you with the compression. So you could absolutely have a full cage filled with concrete. Oh, but it will corrode. That's why we're using cover concrete. So are you telling me that after decades of development of stainless steel, we are still using a heavy carbon content steel for rebars, which is going to be affected by corrosion? And people thought, yes, because that stainless steel is not for rebar. We need to. So we've been working at this something that sooner or later, when I get another sabbatical, I will be able to push some paper out. We've been doing some work here in Sapienza, but it was something that we want to do for a while, which is to work on stainless steel rebars with a good ductility. The stainless steel of the past was not ductile enough. The stainless steel of today, if you ask for that, it can be ductile enough. So eventually, if you can make these rebar corroded protected, there's no need for the rebar to be inside. You can place it outside. So the idea, regardless of the stainless steel, was let's put the reinforcing sacrificial fuse outside. Once you put it outside, you can control it. You can change it, but really becomes a replaceable, external replaceable dissipator. Now, very important. I don't know out of 100, how many of you are students, how many are researchers, how many are engineers. Sometimes people forget about our mission. As a researcher and academic, our mission is to develop and disseminate. At one condition, don't take away credits from who has been developing and researching. You can make money out of our plug and play because we didn't patent it. But when you make money out of it, don't do as it did happen, unfortunately, that you're changing the name just to pretend that you're protecting the system that you invented when it's not yours. So if I give to someone and you guys have a name, a first name given by your parents, it would be offended if someone else would be starting calling you in a different way just because they like, okay? So this is called plug and play. Please, you call it plug and play. If you want to develop something else, you develop something else, but you take it from here, you do a little bit of modification, you call it modified plug and play, but you call it, it's like my name is Stefano, call me Stefano, I'm fine, but it's still either Stefano or Stefano. You don't call me George or John or Tim or whatever else. So very important because, I see Andrea smiling, because in academia, that's what it's the pleasure. It's, imagine if someone was telling, you know the story of the lead rubber bearing? Bill Robinson is well known to be an inventor with Ivan Skinner of lead rubber bearing. There's been a problem, a commercial problem. They literally, I say in a general sense, let's say that someone internationally took the property, inappropriately took the, managed to protect the intellectual property of someone else, okay? Something like this. But everyone knows that they invented it. So they didn't make money out of the royalties. That's unfortunately the problem of a commercial, very aggressive type of environment. But so you can make money, you call it plug and play. If you make them manage to go through the prior art and still patent a variation, feel free. Please remember that this is the concept. Having said that, what was the initial idea? The initial idea, because it's important also to say where it came from. In my mind, this came from, because the model suggestion were two things. Obviously, the buckling restraint brace. There is a buckling restraint brace, which is a monster. It's not a reinforcement, it's a monster. But he's using a anti-buckling tube. So the anti-buckling tube, who is using a grout or something else inside. It's using a flat plate. That monster becoming a small element and becoming a tube, and the tube becoming a fuse, and the fuse becoming the sacrificial elements with a protection. In between that, and in between some work that was being carried out by a very good colleague and friend, Christopoulos, in UC San Diego with Filiatro on steel, they were taking over from the press concrete in San Diego, developing some solutions in steel, which were already in parallel being developed by Lehigh University, just to mention name and surname, Stephen Pesicki and Richard Soles, important. So one of the solutions which I like a lot was that to fix a device, they used a tube. So I thought about tube, interesting, take buckling restraint braces, but think about concrete, and we develop this type of gadget. If you want, what wish. Is a gadget. The idea was to make it becoming absolutely affordable. So we start testing a fuse. There are a lot of details that you can find in latest publication. You can find the first publication in 2005, where I presented that at the FIB conference. In 2006, FIB conference, but in 2005 is a Japanese ATC article. Anyway, you test them in tension, you test them tension and compression. In tension, you yield, and you yield exactly where you want. So you know exactly the area of the fuse. But the dimension of the fuse area, the dimension of the upper diameter, lower diameter, the angle over here, and the length of the tube and the thickness of the tube is not by chance. So there is a lot of development behind experimental analytical to the point that it did not happen yet, but it was, at that time, it was a joke. The plug and play is supposed to be found in a supermarket. So in New Zealand, I was mentioning to a presentation done to deliver to engineers and architects that you're going to find where you go in the electrical parts, when you find the light bulbs, 60 watt, 90 watt, also you're going to find the plug and play devices. You're going to find, instead of watts, is going to be mentioned KN, and everyone will know that W means watts and KN means a kilonewton. Do they need? Do we need to be electrical engineers to understand watt? No, we don't care. We just buy the bulb with 60 watt. If it's a low energy, we are going to try to spend more money to save more money. So same thing here. So we develop an experimental campaign, numerical investigation to have discrete type of elements such that in the same way that an engineer will be using diameter 14, 16, 18, 20, whatever you have in your country, typically they are even number. The odd number are for example, not available in Italy. In the same way, an engineer designer will use a 10, 15, 20 kilonewton, or a 40, a 50, or 60, or a 150, a 200, 250. And an engineer will find a way to discreetly use this type of external plug and play. So just to show you an experimental test, we are testing tension and compression. The idea is to test, be careful, there's a difference between this and the button and strain brace. We have a rocking which is positive displacement and zero displacement, positive and zero. While a buckling restrain in the big sense will have to go in positive displacement and negative displacement. So it's easier to avoid the buckling of such a device because you're just going to, you are going to compression strain, but you're not going to negative compression, negative displacement, excuse me. So the again, I do it again. You have a very fat loop. If you look at the average strain that we are designing for, we are interested to reach 5 to 6%. Typically, we are able to reach 8 to 10. And so we are saying, you see, you're going 6%. You're going to see 8, a lot of cycles. You're engaging fatigue over here. So these type of local issues are now already engaging fatigue, and then the failure is by fatigue. There you are. So 8 was reached, 11. So we say, don't worry. We tested many, take them from the literature. You take them, you scale them up as they are. That's exactly, for example, a difference with the buckling restraint base, the brace device is not scalable in the sense that you don't have the same dimensionless characteristic that you can scale up and down. Each has a different configuration. In this case, they are fully scalable. So what was the idea? To make earthquake engineering user-friendly and let me think about, the terminology, fashion in English would be, moda. Fashion means make it cool. Excuse me but this is exactly the change of thinking that we require. If you make it cool and you start telling to someone that you have different configuration, external, internal in a socket, external, colored, viscous dampers combined with hysteresis, and you look into the room, the joke that I was mentioning is that you can be you can have a dinner, some guests, suddenly you just see some of them looking up in the corner, and looking up in the corner where you have your nice, beautiful SXS 30, whatever, you make a name. SMA, Shen Memory Ilios, Viscous Damper, SMA VC version 4.0. And they were thinking, you know, just imagine the situation. Wow, did you really manage to get it? Yes, you know, I have good friends in Japan. They send me before. It's not even available on the market. There are people lining up on the supermarket to get the new, but it's a good way. I found my way. So it's a joke, but it's not, because think about this. These things that we have are building on commercial, are building on fashion. Honestly, do you really need that camera megabyte, which is killing your hard drive every time? I need to make a phone call. Then I need to check the email. But I'm happy with a 10 years ago version when compared to that. So that's exactly what I was suggesting to the designer and engineer. You go to the supermarket in New Zealand, there are a number of names. So for you, just think about your common supermarket. And you go now, it's Christmas time. You go and buy the 3x2. There's an option, there's a discount. Don't buy the latest viscous damper, Shen Memory Alloys, hysteretic plug and play version. It's a little bit cool and fancy, and it's just for gifts. You buy just after Christmas or after the feast, and you get the discount, and they're going to give it back to you for nothing. So you buy plenty of them. And what are you going to do? You're going to keep in your house, because when there's the need to change a light bulb, you go and change them. And don't tell me that you need to call a PhD in electrical engineering to change the light bulb. Don't tell me that you don't know how electricity works. You would not be able in a after nuclear war to reproduce electricity because it's complicated. I should know it, but I don't really know it, how to do it. So similarly, you don't need to be an electric engineer to go and get your correct plug and play. Difference being, I personally got struggled all the time for getting the type of attach. So the screw type or the, we call it bayonet in Italy, the type of attach. So I always made a mistake. So we thought about to unify the attachment, to make sure that the attachment is, if you wish, company independent. So it's not a matter of no company will be able to then create their special. Look at here. I have all of them with me because depending on, no, we want to have one attachment, which is a universal attachment made in a certain way with a slot. You come in and then nut and counter nut, you connect them. Okay, we are going to have a break because we went exactly where I wanted before having a break of, let's take 15 minutes, a good coffee. It's in Italy, 9:25. Let's go until 9:40. So for you in New Zealand will be the same time, 9:40. 15 minutes from now, and we reconvene back. I'm stopping the registration, the recording, if I can. So I'll see you in 15. Here we are back after the break. So Andre, you were suggesting to absolutely have some interaction and questions. Please shoot. Go ahead.
Maybe the first one, the one that comes to mind now is you're talking about this great idea of, you know, iPhone and having the latest one and having the retrofit solution that's a plug and play, right? That you could use. You know, there's some specific research projects that I'm working on and leading now. If I wanted to have that approximation, how could we start going towards that? Because it's not a commodity yet, right? So what would be the next steps overall in industry and in terms of how can we get there and where should we start?
A topical question, top question. It's happening and I will be able to explain at the end. So I don't want to spoil the surprise, but I can anticipate a couple of things. We need to enter into the culture, looks philosophical, then I go to the practicality. We need to enter into the culture of the people. In New Zealand, the culture was that people are very familiar with seismic engineering. They like the idea to use the top-notch knowledge. They are not concerned about paying money. It looks like an ideal world. It's not. They got there. They got there. When the earthquake happened, there's been, and I will show you, incredible publicity on the media putting from the government to explain new things. And if I go, when I came back to my country in Italy, I was saying that we should just simply do after the TV news at 8 p.m. something like this. And they were looking at me and say, you must be kidding me. This is a joke. You know how much commercial marketing we will be losing? Say, no. What about Publicità Progresso, progress publicity funded by the ministry about don't drive drunk, for example. So it's a cultural change because I go one step up. We need to put the money on the table to show that it's going to be in the long term, going to be cheaper to use this type of technology. Again, different culture will understand that, saying, wow, it's a big investment because I will be paying less after the earthquake. Others will say, I don't care the less because I'm paying more at the beginning. So then there's a next step, which is making affordable from day one, which is exactly what we reached. We manage in New Zealand, I can't disclose the number, but I can show you, I will have a narrative, that we never spend more than the traditional solution. which means that we spend less, but we can't say how less because we have a confidentiality agreement. So now I'm recorded and I'm confirming that I will not be saying how much less we spent, but we know that it didn't cost anymore. So then the big point becomes, then Andre becomes the no-brainer. It doesn't cost anymore. Wow, it's going to save money for everyone. Why don't we implement it? It's a matter of awareness. It's a matter of education. People don't pull, don't ask for that because they don't know. We don't push because engineers, architects, contractors are not familiar with that. Why? Because we don't teach that at undergraduate level or graduate. So in the development, so I'm very pleased that you are asking this question because in the development of the last 20 years, we had to go through all of that in the countries where we were working. And which means engineers were saying, I don't know how to design it. Fair enough. So we need to implement a code. But also after implement a code, I still don't know how to design it because the code is just a code. Fair enough. We have courses for undergrad, but I'm not an undergrad, so it's incredible. Okay, fair enough. We're going to give short courses to engineers. But then my contractor doesn't know. You're right. So basically, the supply chain is being expressed by the local people. And the bottom line is, my client doesn't want to spend more money. And I will be going through all of that because the bottom part is, and I go to Italy, so I'm recorded and I'm loudly saying, in Italy, it's not sufficient to have a doesn't cost anymore, it's going to be better for everyone. You need to put a financial incentives to people, incredible. So we are suggesting to put a financial incentives, and I will show you the numbers on day three, whereby after we are able in Italy now to have a full law for seismic retrofitting, giving financial incentives if you reduce the expected annual loss. And so you go from a seismic rating based on risk and seismic rating based on economical loss. It's been introduced in 2017 to promote retrofitting of existing buildings. So now we want to extrapolate that approach for new design, saying if you are designing according to older approach, you're going to have, the numbers are very clear, we have the numbers, such and such cost of repairing. If you do better than the code, how will government give you the financial incentives? And so basically, you not only will not be spending more, but you're going to make money. This is the only way in this situation to make it happen. Then obviously you have to create a team of people, because if you promote it from a designing point of view, but the contractor is not familiar with that, the contractor will increase the premium in a tender, will go to try to delay, to try to change the solution, which is happening in real life. So you need to start having education also of the construction environment, which is something we typically don't do. We typically have seminars to student researchers, engineers, architects, but we stop at the contractor level. We should be having specific seminars to contractor, and we are organizing something here for timber to bring people on the yard, and really you literally give them a beam, a column and a floor, you give them a crane, and you tell them, can you make them? They get mad, say, of course we can make it. So why you were so upset? I mean, it's a matter of, there's a column, there's a beam, there's a flare. I can paint it by brown, which is timber, and it's light. Wow, it's very light. I can really, so things, there's so much conservatism in the civil engineering, in the civil industry, that people are familiar with what they have been doing and they don't want to change. The only way is really to put money on the table, big money. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. So Andre, I don't know if this is going to help. In the United States, it can happen, the revolution, because in the United States, people are keen with technology. They are concerned about cost like everywhere else. As soon as you start activating improvement in quality technology at equal cost, plus a bit of financial incentives, not necessarily should be cash, can be a fast track in the building consent. So you're saying if you go to a low damage technology, your building consent will be given to you in 3 weeks instead of in a month and a half. This is serious. I will be discounting your occupation of space on site. I will be give you a discount because you're going to be faster. I will be, and so, and so, and so. So there are many ways, depending on the stakeholder, to find the sweet spot to touch.
Yeah, we've seen in the US it's being mainly driven by, you know, big IT corporations, right? And it's also their incentive is the image of their brand. So that is the big push that's helping, you know, all the topics you mentioned, mass timber, low damage designs. They want to show off their commodity. So they want to show off their energy dissipation devices. They want it apparent. But it's that's how it's being moved in the US, but it's still a very niche market. It's better than nothing. But how do we make it a commodity? Yeah. Very good. Thanks so much. That was a good discussion.
Thank you. Because it's interesting that the whole world is going. So there's another step up, which I will be mentioning, but it's really, I'm anticipating. When we started working on the timber and we developed the timber version, we were doing. Then we start thinking about is the other way around. We did not honestly do a market analysis to understand what was needed. We first developed, then we thought about, wow, there's quite an interesting niche over here, open space, multi-story building, carbon credits, Kyoto Protocol. Interesting, they can match. The Kyoto Protocol didn't go anywhere. But we were really thinking that carbon credit would have launched, would have revamped the use of timber, for example, in the future. Now, look at what's happening. Green Deal in Europe, unbelievable. Now, everyone is asking for that. They want to see the number. They want to understand what's going on. Sustainability, carbon dioxide, life cycle analysis. I'm going so fast that not even the translator is doing. So sadly, all the politicians want to have the number that for 20 years you have been working on, and so we have them. It's just that we didn't prepare in such a way, because they want to go for a new law, stamping their own name on that new fantastic law, which is going to be saving the world from a sustainability point of view, demonstrated that with the low damage, sustainable material, sustainable design, I will try to explain what I have in the title. Sustainable design means that we don't have to change too much the building when we change the use. We have existing buildings in Italy, whereby the trap, they are becoming a trap from a functional point of view, because you would like to refurbish them, but the corridors are too narrow, there are too many walls, you cannot break everything. So if we start thinking about open space design from a structural point of view, it would be much easier to change the use. And we did an exercise, which has been a brilliant thesis of a student from Architecture Laurie Seminary, where we took conceptually preliminary design a mall to become a school and vice versa. So just imagine the two opposites. A mall requires open space, enter, flow of people, aggregation, but a lot of movement. A school requires rooms, corridor, everything is very... So we managed to show that if you design properly with a low damage prefabricated technology, then with some small movement of few elements, you can completely show, change the use of the building, which means that you're elongating the lifespan of the building. If material and the design is durable enough, then it's not a matter of not being functional enough from the point of view of the community. So you can have a residential building becoming a commercial, becoming a hotel, going back to residential, mixed retail use. So this is all part of a planning of the city. So it's actually much bigger level, high level than an individual building. So going to whoever is thinking about a new city design in China or in the Middle East, just to think about those things happening incredibly, or reconstruction of a city after an earthquake, where you don't really know, as it was in Christchurch, who's going to go there? Because people moved out. Are they going to go back with their own business? Maybe not. So you need to create a flexible type of design from a use point of view. And this means a different type of, from the beginning, design where you have the services already pre-dimensioned for different usage. Think about the water, electricity, power plant. They need to be already thought to be engaged in 20 years from now without having to break the topping of the slab. So this requires us to do, again, a flexible, sustainable design, which you think of at least about a couple of changes in the use of the building in the next 100 years. And this includes the dress. The dress means the energy efficiency dress, which can be facades and so forth. In a circular economy point of view, we would like, and we have been doing the numbers to think that I'm putting a new energy efficiency facade. I'm changing my windows. I'm doing everything in a way that is a plug and play. I like it because people, and I'd say fantastic, I love them. They said, you are talking about a plug and play facade. Can we mention that? Absolutely, yes. The plug and play was for something else, but yes, a plug and play facade tells you I put my coat on, and then when it's the time to take it off, because in 20 years from now, the energy efficiency requirements will change. So my coat used in northern part of Italy, A plus coat, energy efficiency dress, will become a B plus over there, but will be an A plus in Rome. So thank you very much. If you put some sensors to check in a BIM environment, building instrumentation model, the history of that coat, I will be happy to buy it, a second hand. And a second hand coat in facade in the environment, in the civil engineering environment, is something that so far we thought it would be absurd. It's the same thought that our two generations behind, grandparents, were thinking about buying an old car. You don't buy an old car, you buy a car, right? At that time, you were buying a car. You were not buying a second-hand car. It was offensive. And then slowly, slowly, we started thinking that a second-hand is nothing bad, right? If you have a good quality control. So we buy second-hand houses, interestingly, obviously. We buy second-hand cars, we buy second-hand everything. And so if we start thinking that a second-hand dress, a facade, a window, properly controlled with sensors, will be able to move around, this is sustainability. This is really big numbers in terms of CO2 emission, everything else. Thank you. Other questions? I will be trying to go through and I will give you some papers at the end, because it's a these are much a high level than a mathematical approach, but is the change, the big gear changing, the step change can happen when we go out of our engineering mathematical confined and safe environment into literally communication to people, engagement with stakeholders, understanding what does it mean, because the law in Italy are different than the law in New Zealand. If I try to explain here about private insurance, people will be thinking that, no, they will say, you have been abroad too much, you don't understand. Say, yeah, no, it's not that I don't understand. I do, that's why I suggest you try to create a similar model in our own environment. It's not that it doesn't make any sense. It's just that, let me think about it, should be the answer. Cannot be implemented over here. Let me think about it. We were going to try to find a way. And so it takes time. It takes time. But having said that, when I will be showing now the building in New Zealand, the building in the US first, but then in New Zealand, I remember a comment from someone saying, it took a while, but you got it. See, it took a while. 1999, we tested in San Diego a five-story building. 2002, I'm entering into New Zealand with my broken English, try to develop further. In 2006, we managed to have a code in New Zealand. In 2008, we have buildings, and you're telling me it took a while? You don't know how the world takes. The world takes 30 years to just, in the civil engineering environment, to start thinking about applying something. So the point is, why it was feasible over there? Because there was a synergy of academia, a very fertile type of environment, which was definitely prepared by the Park and Poly and the priestry of the sort, whereby people were keen to listen. We had political people, politicians coming to the lab regularly. Politicians, in depending on where the country, in which country you are from, just to give an example again, I'm recorded and I have to be careful, but at the same time, I can take advantage of that. I'm in Rome now, Sapienza. If I walk a few hundred meters, I go to the Prime Minister's office, to the Parliament. Everything is here. So in New Zealand, we were receiving every month a politician coming and asking, politician equal to elected person on the public, my public duty is to do what I've been elected, I'm representing the population. So they're coming and saying, what can I do? I couldn't believe it. This is in my brain at that time was still incredible. So you, high-level politician, is coming to learn what's going on and saying how you can help. I can't imagine. And they were thinking, of course, it's my job. And they were actually even explaining to me, ignorant of that type of culture, that my job is really to do something which would be useful. I'm all thinking, wow, I thought that was on the books, but not on the real life. So every once in a while, we receive people who were asking what to do, and I will show you what they did. They put laws, they put public marketing. So when I go back to Rome, I say, easy. Now, I will be in trouble to fix my agenda because I will be receiving an invasion of politicians. We have many over here asking to see the lab and to see what we're doing with the timber and steel we are doing now, post-tension timber and steel connection since years. They will be asking to come, and we don't even have the space. No one. When we try to engage in some conditions that the television knew about something and they wanted to go for publicity, we thought that they were doing what they were doing also in New Zealand. I will show you a New Zealand publicity, or a New Zealand television information, which was, we come, we listen, we spend hours, journalists with you, to understand what you're talking about. We try to make a summary. We ask you to check the summary. We try to understand if we are going, I'm here, they are saying, so we're going to come and say, can I see what you're going to write? Of course not, this is a secret. We can't leak the information in the Italian environment. So see, listen, it doesn't work. I mean, you're going to explain something very important. Your mission is even more important than mine because you're explaining to the population. The answer is we don't have the time. Of course, we don't have the time to come and spend hours with you explaining Herbig engineering. Just give us a few sentences and we are going to arrange for that. I'm exaggerating, but not too much. Not too much. So to go to the point that you were mentioning, Andre, it's a matter of understanding the culture. Sometimes it's easier to be a Martian in a different country because people will think that you're crazy and will respect your craziness. While you are back to your own country, then they can't understand why you speak in a crazy way. And you try to say that I've been abroad too much. It's my fault, you know. It's obviously my fault. Sorry, I just don't understand what the problem is. And so they say, okay, you've been abroad too much. Get back and try to reconciliate with your own. You see the point? Incredible. So it takes time. But having said that, we are going to have in few months the first Pressland building in the Amatrice, which is the city where the earthquake in central Italy happened in 2016. It took years to design, years to be approved, years to be constructed. They are constructing the foundation now. So it's happening. It took really a while because there was no need, but it was definitely a big step. Other question before I go, I saw a chat, excuse me. I saw a chat. We have the same problem in India, where we are still practicing.
Can I ask my question?
Dhruvi, you want to talk, please?
Thank you. Sir, sorry.
Dhruvi, please.
No, sir. I had the same problem that Andrew discussed, right? So we have the same problem here in India about, like, we use a lot of traditional construction practices. So for us to make people understand that you're not in safer structure, it's too tiring. And so we cannot use new latest advancements. So that was the same problem that I was facing and I needed an answer. So I just expressed it in the message.
Thank you, Dhruvi. At the same time, I'm a bit familiar with India development in the last 10 years because I've been there and few people have been there. And there's been a huge push. I know that from your side, it looks like not much, but a big push on precasting to increase the quality control. And so precasting, which was not part of the Indian construction, has been developing a lot with the new plants, new machines, people understanding it is time to invest. And it's a big step because precasting is not considered worth unless the per hour rate of worker becomes too high. So only when the per hour worker rate, the wage becomes high, then it's worth switching to precast. In India, the wage is low. So introducing precasting has been a big push from the high level, from the, I say, the government, to try to change the quality control. And this is, I think, has been absolutely brilliant. Then India is so big that with a few plants in north, in the northern part, a few in Bangalore, you can't really afford to serve. But there's really a step change happening for what I saw in the last 10 years, really sudden. They said, we are going to make a big change. Then obviously we are dealing with the daily basis. But what Andre was mentioning makes sense. It also has been a reaction from some people don't want to be the first ones because they are concerned. Some people want to be the first ones because they're going to be taking advantage of the publicity. And that's the type of button that you need to push depending on who you're talking to. Not everyone is born to be a leader. But once you see that someone are keen, go for it. And the other one will follow. So it's okay. There are people who are just comfortable in their own, you know, it's just a matter of no offense, different people have different characters. If you manage to get a team where they are all keen to push because they have their own reasons, satisfaction, publicity, money that comes back in the long term and whatever else, that's where you get that done. And then, for example, what I'm not able to do here yet, is I walk by in the city that I was doing Christchurch to show buildings. Because once you go about the city and you're walking and you enter into a coffee and you show the dissipation devices after you offer the coffee, you don't say, you just go there and say, as if it was the most easy, obvious things. And by the way, what is that? What do you mean, what is it? What do you think it is? It's a plug and play. It's a 20 kilonewton plug and play. And that's a viscous damper combining para. That's a rocking system. But let's enjoy the coffee. We were here for another reason. So once this becomes normal, you start getting into buildings which are real. I got people taking a flight and coming to New Zealand because they saw many of my presentation and they think, I still cannot believe it. I mean, the presentation are showing slides. A slide is a slide, but entering physically into an office of someone and sitting down in the meeting room and looking at the plug and play there and seeing the post-tensioning in the basement and seeing, it's a completely different thing. And people were asking, we were having, I prepared some video recording for the Italian television. They asked for an interview, and I happened to be in New Zealand. It was February 2020, just when things were going wrong, pandemic-wise. I managed to get to New Zealand, deliver a course, and I got a call from Italian television to have an interview. And we were discussing about these low damage. I said, listen, I'm in the right spot. I will be going about the walking in the city, and with a video, I will be basically being a journalist on site. So we prepared that, and believe it or not, they had to postpone three times from February to June that type of program, which was about a new technology for construction because the COVID took over. Once the COVID took over, then the interest of people about earthquake, you can imagine, forget about it, please. Actually, it becomes really worse. You don't want in that extreme situation to talk about earthquake and life safety. Forget about it. It's just wrong. So they when they mentioned they managed to get onto the television, basically the long topic interview became literally 1 minute and 15, where I said that it doesn't cost more to do better and a few other things. But the whole explanation was completely cut. So there are opportunities and we need to take them when they are happening, because people are, the population is not ignorant by definition. They are keen to know. The decision making from the high level is why we don't let them know, thinking that there will be a revolution. And I will explain you later on. But there was another Bijan. Bijan, I think you were. I saw.
Hi, how are you? I don't know that. Can you hear me clearly or not?
We can, but we can't see you. So you're like on a radio.
I'm so sorry for I can't. I do not have a proper camera. I'm so sorry. Okay. Thank you for interesting presentation. As I understand it, there is a inconsiderable decreasing in the uncertainties, because when we can use calculate moment curvature with hand calculation, it, in my opinion, it shows us a very decreasing amount, a great decreasing in uncertainties. And it's very useful for high risk fields that I'm working in that field, especially in industrial plants. I would like to know that, is there any sample of usage of this plug and play for industrial facilities, industrial plants, for example, for tanks or for pipe racks or any other facilities? Have you seen any usage of these, or do you have any comment on this idea or not?
Yeah. Again, Bijan, thank you. I can give you a list of either application or proposed application. The first one are on precast industrial buildings. For example, beams connected onto cantilever columns with a big corbel. You can basically use a device like the plug and play anywhere where you're getting a relative displacement. But Bijan, please don't make me fall in the same trap I didn't want you to fall, which is not the device. It's not my beautiful, fantastic, amazing, unbiased baby plug and play that is going to make your building seismic proof or low damage. It's the design itself. So not suddenly you take something, you plug it in, and eventually you have. Having said that, certainly, for example, we've been using a plug and play. I will show you in the retrofit of a church, a church Knox in Christchurch. It's a timber church where buttresses made of column, basically the rocking column with the plug and play on the base are being adopted. You can use anything like a rocking wall, a rocking column as a buttress for anything. You can use a tie back for reinforced masonry facades to be using in series a plug and play. So it's a tendon with in series a plug and play. So in a truss type of building, in a tank, if you let the tank rocking, you have to check the elephant, famous elephant foot type of buckling at the base. But if you confine that, absolutely you can have, and that has been some work also in New Zealand, in Napier, in the region where we have a very good, Blenheim, the region near Kaikoura, where we have good vineyards. And many tanks where you can confine with a basically a steel channel the base to avoid the buckling, and then you can add plug and play devices. You can use them for bridges, for infrastructures, because you can retrofit an existing column or existing bridge pier by using again a belt, and then you're attaching the plug and play the base using selective weakening. So there are literally long list, almost infinite of application that you can think, because the way of thinking about low damage can be adopted for anything, for pipelines, can be adopted for any type of connection detailing, where you, instead of using weld, so elastobrittle, you are using geometry. So tongue and groove, in Italy, we call it male-female, can be called tag and groove. So any detailing can be taking advantage of relative movement, or where you know the relative movement is, you can protect it and taking advantage of that for a dissipation point of view. Make sense?
Yeah, thank you so much. Absolutely. That was a very complete answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we go back to, I want to show you, hold on a second, a few things. I have a lot to show, but I want to also do in a different way. Okay, there you are. Second. Sure. Okay, sorry, because I didn't, I should have, I didn't record it. What a pity. I don't think I started back recording. Is are we recording? Can you check?
It is recording now. I don't know when it started.
Okay, okay, thank you. So let me take this away and we put over there. There you are, there you are. Okay, so basically really trying to follow the full path. We can call it implementation path. So implementation path means that you start with an idea, you start developing that idea into a research and development with the practical objective. Otherwise, otherwise doesn't work. So, and it's not an easy thing. So if you think about your most brilliant ideas that you are working on in your research, you need to think about what it will look like at the end. The idea could be that you are maybe working on an algorithm for optimization of something. So it's fundamental you start thinking from the beginning, okay, where, for example, can I adopt DEX, optimization algorithm theory? And it doesn't matter if you don't have all the answer, but just one practical implementation of DEX is fundamental to show that it's worth using it, is actually having an impact on the society. Otherwise, it stays there, and it's a pity. So the new way of doing research, even though you might appear to be working on something extremely theoretical, is give me an example, give me an application, prepare a MATLAB code with an app that everyone can use over here, for example, too, and you're creating Google Map, and you're creating an optimization of the path that you need to do to go from A to B, depending on the traffic. So you see the point? It's very important that we start thinking a different way. The pleasure of doing research, sometimes I'm saying, should not be confused. It should not be stopped by the falling in love with the mathematics. The mathematics should be the tool, not the objective of our research. The objective is something else. The mathematics, which is this elegant expression where we really love. I could have given you all differential equations and everything else about the stress strain relationship. I don't care here. We are discussing about the outcome. Obviously, if you want to go back, you're going to find all the publication that you need. So we make the architecture configuration can be plug and play outside. And here we are 2004, just to give an idea. This is type of experimental testing. It's important also to remember the research contributors in Tom Pauli terminology, the victims of the research. Alejandro Amaris did a fantastic PhD working on the binclinal joint. Dion Marriott working on binclinal joint, on bridge and walls. Cam Wang working on different type of things. And we are going to see all of them. Design code implementation. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the, and you should be, with the FIB bulletins, the FIB bulletins. The FIB itself is an entity which has been a volunteering society, a learned society, which is merging from CEB and FIP. CEB is a Comité Européen du Béton, so European Committee of Concrete, which then from European became Euro International. And FIP was International Federation of Pre-Stress. They merged together in the 80s approximately. They became FIB written in italics. The FIB bulletins are pre-code, are knowledge written by volunteers, committee of academic industry and everything else, writing the state of art or top notch of that topic, which will be slowly or quickly becomes code, provisions, guidelines in different countries. In the 2003, there is a publication, Seismic Design of Precast Concrete Building Structures, which is the one on the left-hand side. Chairing that committee, Professor Bob Park, Robert Park, for everyone, Bob Park, and Fumio Watanabe, Professor Watanabe, Watanabe-sensei from Kyoto University. In that committee made of many international people, we manage, I had the honor to be part of that, to write up also the latest development into rocking hybrid systems. So 2004, which for your means 2003, 20 years ago, folks, you should have known that. And when people today don't know yet that this was already out, it's not good. We cannot complain about the contractors being far away, if you, our job as an engineer, regardless of being a researcher, non-researcher, is to stay up to track. So FIB 2004 is already explaining what we knew. Then New Zealand standard 311/2006 drafted already 2004 in the appendix B is explaining into the detailing is becoming the first code in the world which could be used by everyone else in the world because everyone else in the world could use a well accepted code internationally approved. And then more recently we're going to some more details about detailing precast concrete buildings in seismic areas. A co-chair together with Professor Spiro Soukantas, late Professor Soukantas, unfortunately passed away recently. And when we were discussing about India, he spent a number of years in India. He moved from Greece to India and he really pushed a lot for precast. So one of the reasons for which I knew about what was going on is that literally he committed himself with his team, staying physically, started living over there, to work on precasting, developing precast in India. Not happy of a code, so we are now using the New Zealand standard 311/2006 is a concrete code. The appendix B is providing you everything, but not happy, obviously, you need to provide design examples. So we work with the Concrete Society and we provided the press design and book. Again, don't tell me if you are familiar or work in this space that you don't have a copy of the press design and book. Now, if you send an email properly, the cost of that was quite high, but we agreed that for students, it would have been 50 New Zealand dollars, which are 30 euros or a bit more in US or a bit equal in terms of US dollar. So you're able to get a copy. Over the year, you will find a full design example of a five-story building with frames in one direction, walls in the others, including the development of single or couple walls with U-shaped flexure plates, and so forth and so forth. Okay, so fundamental to be able to have it. But let's go back. And now I will be confusing you a bit because once while things are developing, and we are here in 2006 in New Zealand, and we are getting buildings basically up, starting from this moment up. Let's go back. First is not really the first; is the highest application about the press technology is the Paramount Building in San Francisco. We are talking about a 39-story building. So if you want to go higher or having the highest in the world, you have to go for a 40-story. So 39, San Francisco, high seismic region, designed by Bob Engelkirk, 2002. This is basically a building. Okay, I don't have here the picture. I will have in different other slides. It's basically a building which is using the press technology with what it was available at that time, what I call generation zero. So the original post tension in the center, unbonded, top and bottom mild steel internal, because we had not yet developed the external plug and play. That was what we had. But you need to know that while, and I will show you a video now, the five-story building, the press building tested in the lab at UC San Diego was a five-story building. That five-story building was tested in, we finished in, starting in 98 and finishing in 99. So September 99, we have the building tested, which was an incredible success. The technology was so advanced that PAMCO Corporation, a big contractor in the West in California, did not wait for the end of the test in 1999. They already had some trial buildings secretly almost done in East Coast of the United States because the technology was so promising that they wanted to get their hands on. So it's interesting because in many cases, we don't know, at least for a while in the US environment, about a number of buildings which were developed with the generation zero because people wanted to make their own market advantage by protecting the information and not developing. So this is not the first building. There were a few other first buildings on the East Coast. This is the tallest and the most obviously outstanding. But I like to move from here to there, from US to Italy, because 1999, we make the presentation. I had the pleasure to be personally presenting the preliminary results using the Italian language at the Italian conference in earthquake engineering, which in Italy is a big thing. So we are getting out from US. We did not have any presentation done yet, even in US. I presented the results, and thanks to a company which is called BS Italia, who was familiar with the American market and was actually present at some of the PCI conventions in the United States, we started fast and quick to develop some experimental testing for draped tendon solution to be adopted in the Italian environment when the seismicity is not too high. So it's a matter of combining the name was the Brooklyn system. The name was given by the company. So their credit for the name, thinking about the Brooklyn system and really merging the press technology with the concept of tendons also going up and down following the bending moment diagram. And so we have building up since 2004, and we presented, it's incredible, the if you think about it, from United States, an Italian company sees at the PCI convention is aware of these things. So we start discussing about developing that in Italy after the presentation in Italy. And where do we present the D1 of or the first building developed in Italy? In New Zealand. At the 2004 conference in Concrete Society conference in New Zealand, we presented a paper and we received the award of Sandy Cormack Award for the paper. So in a way, you know, when we say nemo profeta in patria, so you will not be a prophet in your own country. It is absolutely true, unfortunately. You need to jump from one country to the other to be able to explain the beauty of what has been developed in other places. So in New Zealand, we presented the work done in Italy, which has been pioneered in the United States. And in New Zealand, the people are thinking that's brilliant. We would like to do in the same way. Other application, Argentina, Mendoza, Costa Rica. These are all information that we got starting sharing information. So I have nothing to do with this and that, but it's a sharing of slides with Olsim Producto de Concreto in Costa Rica, because we started having presentation, for example, in Mexico with the Precast Concrete Association and the Rose School in Pavia that you might hopefully trustly being familiar with, so European School in Earthquake Engineering, developing since 2001, was attracting international students, amongst which there were quite a group regularly coming from engineering consulting company in Costa Rica. They are very advanced in earthquake engineering. They were keeping themselves up to speed by sending engineers to the Rose School, and specifically they were sending them to learn the new trends in low damage. And the first course that I introduced, it was in 2000, if I remember properly, 2007. So starting in 2007, they were already doing their own things, but they kept doing more and more and more. So then we go to New Zealand. And so now the time is becoming here. You can see over there, 2009 construction time. We are in Wellington. This is the first multi-story building that we managed to get up with Dunning Thornton, Alistair Katanak from Dunning Thornton. I've been helping peer reviewer, but quasi independent. So from the beginning, you teach, you use your academic hat, you teach displacement-based design, you teach precast, then you wear your rear viewer hat, you have workshop around the table. So it's been a fantastic synergy in terms of work. And these buildings is using both precast frames. Will you see here the plug and play devices on the beam column connection and wall to foundation connection, as well as post-tension walls with coupling beams. You can see here the site, and you can find all these papers in the repository, which I will give you a link to. So you have plug and play, but the interesting part is that this is the construction site. So there is no propping, everything is dry. And think about a dry, which means a not wet trades on site. This means safety. One of the reasons for which the contractor really loved the system was safety on site. Precast, floors, post-tension, plug and play, done. Basically fast and quick, you save a lot of money. So it's not really only safety on site. You go fast and quick, you declare a number of months and you are engaging less people on site, or you're going faster and you're saving times. This is a nice picture of us much younger and happy. This is Alistair Katanak. This is Adam Thornton, the founder of Dunning-Thornton, and now recently designed. Really, really a small to medium enterprise in New Zealand, who started from a while, from Adam Thornton, literally pushed very hard, very much into technology. So they really got into that type of things. We are going to Christchurch. So from Wellington, we are going South Island into the city, which we didn't know was waiting for the earthquake to happen. Or better, we knew that there were earthquakes to happen, but we did not expect the 2010-11. So here, together with the Stratex, now it's called Quoin, Stratex Metro. There are different type of, it's important to give the due diligence credits. You're going to find all of them. Gary Averland, specifically, and then we wrote a paper together. We have a Southern Cross Hospital building. So we have a portion of a private hospital buildings, which needs to have obviously high performance. One of the options is base isolation. Then the manager makes a basically call for a meeting because they heard about this low damage technology. They want to know more. And the instruction is very clear, which I am able to say afterwards without saying the number. Let's consider a press technology. If it doesn't cost more, I will be considering that. So the client is not saying, I love a low damage. He's saying, if you are able to show me that it doesn't cost more, I will consider that. We are able to show savings in a number of things. The type of solution is what New Zealand can do it easily, precast or low-core. It's just a matter of leaving, I'm simplifying, leaving holes with ducts and doing the post-tensioning. It's just a matter of leaving a proper location for the, in this case, the plug and play were not outside. It's a different type of building. The energy dissipation is inside. But basically, it was not hard to convince a good precaster and good contractor that they can do it. It's not a big deal to have, if you call it a different way, a tie back. If you call it tie down or tie back, suddenly people are not anymore concerned. If you call it post-tensioning, it's complicated. If you call it dissipators, it's a concern. If you call it a piece of steel, oh, it's a piece of steel. Of course, we put piece of steel everywhere. So just tell me what piece of steel you need to put in. So it's really also fundamental to not to scare off. This building went through the earthquakes. It got the September 2010, but also got to the February 2011, and basically was unscathed. There was some minor tiny issue with, you see these water pipes. In one location, these water pipes broke off and it leaked water, which was really a pity, because people don't think about designing even the slot of the, it was just an implementation issue, which is off the seismic engineering design, but just a tiny thing. But you see here the walls being connected by U-shaped flexural plates, which worked because you can check the paint. The paint is being broken, so they went for plastic. There was no reason, no need to change them. They can take a big number of cycles. There was a publication in the 70s by Skinner and Kelly, Jim Kelly, professor from Berkeley, who came in sabbatical to New Zealand to share from Berkeley and learn from Canterbury, from New Zealand, generally speaking, the seismic engineering trends. And basically, these U-shaped flexural plates are absolutely a very good solution, which can be adopted for many reasons. So the hospital is occupable immediately. The building is in between, very nearby the city center, where plenty of buildings are down. Many buildings are collapsed. Many other buildings are damaged, not repairable. So the media is asking the question. There is a building up, which is being used by civil protection. And let's go and look at what it is. And it would be certainly very expensive, but let's go and investigate. So they come to interview in the lab. I have an interview. We have an interview with Gary Averland. You can find them on the web with the designer. I explain a few things and I said I cannot talk about money. I can say that it didn't cost any more than a traditional solution. Gary Averand has a different confidentiality agreement contract, so he can say the number. So he starts saying, we save $300,000 a year by reducing the shear and the foundation in the walls, because if you rock a wall, you can get some advantages. We saved here a torsional steel frame, which was not required because we checked with 3D analysis that it was not required. So there were savings and savings and savings. Then they interview the CEO of Southern Cross, who very proudly says, we invested in this new technology because we believe in safety. In the crossing of interview, it was clear that you invested because you believe in safety, and also open the brackets, because it didn't cost anymore, actually you saved money. So this became a big deal because people knew that there are things available in New Zealand that can be designed by code, by designers are able to do it. Contractor can construct it easily. We can save time and money, no brainer. This is just an example of other buildings. Rotorua, we are in North Island, police station, you understand police station, strategic building. And again, it's a matter of getting into a low damage of high performance. The challenge here is that Rotorua stays in a very active geotechnical, geothermal area. So the foundation are tricky. And you want to have a low damage, superstructure and low damage, geotechnical part. And this was not easy because there was no discussion about what is the low damage foundation type. So we argued, discussed, convened and agreed. And at the end, look at the police station. You're in the corridor. And just imagine, honestly, we didn't want to have so many plug and play. We could have made half of them with a bigger size. There's a wall. You can see here the protection for the cover concrete not to be spalled out. So when we do a low damage, we want to protect the cover concrete from spalling. So basically, literally, there is no damage in the element. And the only damage is in the plug and play. You are in a corridor. Just imagine the daily use of the police station with people confidently seeing that they are safe. And the joke was, when you are being caught by police, you can't care the less about being safe in the corridor, because you're going to go to prison, maybe it's going to be hopefully safe enough. But the idea was literally to show that this is safety and not to hide that. 2,500 years later, then the ancient temples, we are designing something and constructing, which is, I'm using Italian approach because people always think that Italy is conservative, fair enough, it is. That there are a lot of monuments and heritage buildings, fair enough, it is. It has nothing to do with the opportunity to design new structures in a different way. You can see here the post-tensioning holes, where the post-tensioning in this case will be going top and bottom all the way back, following the bending moment diagram. So you can have double ducts. You can really push for long span. That's where the benefit of post-tensioning, moving the theory from bridges into buildings, allows you for open space. So we literally starting, we said, why not in timber, honestly, by chance. We are in New Zealand. I'm teaching this low damage for undergrad and graduate level, and I'm using a timber model like you would be doing for any big church or monument in the past had always a wood type of model to understand what's going on. So to explain in class, I get in New Zealand, they work a lot on timber. The houses, the dwellings, one story, two stories are timber made. So timber is a normal material that people are very familiar with, to play, to break, to work and so forth. So we have this model. And while we're using this model to explain it in the lab, I see more and more of a different type of timber, not wood, but an engineered wood. So a laminated timber of a new generation, not glulam, which is known as a laminated timber, but LVL, laminated veneer lumber. So there is more special material coming up in the lab to do some testing. And so literally we say, why don't we try in timber? And if you think about timber tall buildings is not a novelty. So if you look at the pagoda in the, let's say, Japan, China, Korea, so in the East Asia, you will find buildings, tall buildings. As long as you kept them, you protect them from water, you keep them dry, they can last as long as you wish. Similarly, in Austria, Germany, in the northern part of Italy, going all the way up, they are not in a high seismic region if you stay in Italy, in Europe, but in Japan and so forth, they are. So multi-story timber buildings is not a novel. If you go to the what timber is used and how it is used for residential buildings, this is typically the 4x2 or 2x4, so what we call light timber frames. So almost any colleague or any friend in New Zealand would be able to construct their own houses because it's easy, they know how to do it, so they would be able, without being a formal contractor, to do it. Then obviously there is a license required more recently, but this is something that has been done. We are not talking about this timber. We are not even talking about this timber, which is plywood shear walls. So it's becoming now bigger, four-story. You go to California and you look at the motels, and they might have one, two-story or three, four stories on the top of a one-story made of maybe concrete. So things are becoming higher and higher until literally recently, we're talking about 10 to 15 years, people started using the new engineered wood, started thinking about, again, multi-story buildings. So there are examples of six, seven stories in Germany, in Switzerland, in UK, and more is happening with designs in the Central Europe of 10 to 12 stories, with 10 to 15 stories in Australia. And these are using a different type. You see here, glulam or X-lam, also called cross-lam or also called CLT, cross-laminated timber. So the properties of timber, you might know, are strong in the direction of the growth of the tree. And so they are basically strong parallel to the grain, we call it, and they are weak perpendicular to the grain. It's not isotropic as a material, like in a way concrete look like. So it's not equally performing in all directions, but in its non-isotropic behavior, at least, is orthotropic. So the longitudinal and the parallel to the longitudinal to the fiber behaves in an equal way. So perpendicular to perp to grain, we say, and parallel to grain, in an orthotropic approach, they work properly. So New Zealand started in importing and creating facilities to develop this laminated veneer lumber, which is a very special laminated timber. Specifically, is a timber that is able to develop a veneer of 3 millimeters. How does it work? You basically, really talking about the famous commodity, there's a lot of pine. Radiata pine is a soft wood. In New Zealand, thanks to the conditions of the weather, sun, water, water, sun, water, water, sun, is like mushrooms. You grow timber fast. So the harvesting time in New Zealand for pine forests is much faster than, for example, in California. So you have a cheap, soft material, which if engineered in a solution which I will show you, you might be familiar with, can become, from a commodity, can become a very important structural system. If you go and see what it looks like, these plants are absolutely astonishing. These plants are, which are basically this, these plants are prefabricated plants made of timber buildings, obviously, with the machines which are running, coming back, running, coming back. So they are basically beds, machine beds, which are peeling the log. And the log comes from forests which has already been graded. So you start like you would be doing for orange tree or an apple tree, for fruits trees. You will be start combining and selecting forest type A, forest type B, forest type C. That's what already New Zealand is able to do. So you pick up and choose already the very strong grade, the very strong material with a very soft one, because in an I-shaped joist, you might want to have the very, very strong one on top and bottom, which are the cords, and the web is the soft one. So you can optimize the selection of the material depending on your use. But basically, you're peeling a log by by pinning literally by veneers. And these veneers are running and be already selected depending on the first peel. Remember, when you're peeling an apple, the first peel is never good. After you go about a bit, it becomes regular. The same thing happened with log. The first peel is being thrown away. The second, and the second, after a while, it becomes after quite immediately, gets okay. It gets checked in a incredible high-tech way with the ultrasound, with laser. It gets glued, spread, and then you are re-putting them together, putting slowly, drying up in a press, and then you soak up. What happens is that your sawn timber, which has an imperfection, which is the notch, is going to be saw cut in 3 millimeters. So it's going to be, cut in 3 millimeters. When you recombine them the layer, it's statistically improbable, it is possible, but statistically improbable, that you're going to layer up again the same 3 millimeters of notch in the same location. So the weak point is spread around, which means, look at here, the E modulus of a sawn timber, a normal timber, is about 8 gigapascal. Remember that in concrete, we are talking about 30 gigapascal, okay, 30,000 megapascal. But with LVL, with glulam, you go to 12 approximately, depending, between 8 and 12. With LVL, you can go to 11, 13, and even 16. In Australia, they're able to do a 16. So the E modulus is similar to a third or a quarter than concrete. But if you're thinking about cracked concrete will have an EI gross becoming EI cracked. So a cracked concrete section will have the same stiffness of a non-cracked post-tension, and now we see the point, timber type of section. So from here, we literally start thinking, why don't we develop the whole thing in timber? So it was not a joke. It was a, why don't we try? We started with a proposal, and I'm proud to tell everyone that don't give up. It does work in the sense, never give up. But we made a proposal at the same EQC, which is this brilliant concept in New Zealand. But the brilliant concept is not EQC, is made of people around the table who evaluating a research proposal that we made, where we are proposing to create this post-tension timber stuff. The answer was, thank you, no thank you. We suggest to Stefano to continue his brilliant work on concrete, because timber is a live. I don't go to the details, but the concept, the prejudice was, timber is more alive than concrete, timber has a long-term viscosity, which is great, timber is soft, timber is flexible, why do we want to post-tension? Forget about that, it cannot be done. Of course, we did it. So thank you for not founding us. We are going to get a little bit of material. And in the lab, we developed this concept. Why did we call it as we call it? Quite simple after a while. Laminated veneer lumber, LVL. Glulam is the most famous laminated timber, glued lam, which comes with 4 or 5 centimeters, 40, 50 millimeters of bricks glued together in the vertical direction. If you go to a swimming pool, you're going to see the effect of timber bricks, basically, looks like. LVL is the other way around. LVL goes, you're going to find in front of you, the beam will look like a beautiful timber skin, because the veneer are in a beam vertically oriented. So you're going to see in a different way. And the cross lam is actually a way to improve the perpendicular to the grain behavior by crossing the parallel to the grain with a perpendicular to the grain, parallel to the grain, perpendicular to the grain. You try to make a odd number, and you create the cross lam or X lam or cross laminated timber. So if you start putting post tensioning or pre-stressing, how would you call it? There it is. We call it press lam. So same thing like the plug and play. The name is press lam. The name is not something else. It's not you in scientific publication, because of you need to shorten the acronym. I still receive plenty of review. I don't mind anymore, but it's not appropriate. Instead of talking about press technology, the name is press technology. Call it press technology. They call it post beam column joint post tension with the rocking. So they call it PCTVVB. But why do you need to do it? Why using an acronym where it's called press? You call it press technology, you're not going to pay royalty to anyone, you're just referring to the proper thing, and you are explaining if you can, the novelty of your detailing when compared to the original one or the one developed in literature. So don't wake up in the morning saying, you know what? I thought about taking a concrete, a timber, a Greek temple, and adding a vertical tie. And I thought about calling in a different name. Doesn't work like that, okay? So 2000, we are here in 2006. So what happens? In 2005, we made a publication where we already have the solution developed and tested in the lab. This is already happening in parallel to the development in concrete. So to explain the interesting part of research and development, we are pushing on the concrete part and we are developing in the concrete part the plug and play. We are initiating the timber press slam development, but we have a huge already path ready to go to mix and match. So the concrete was borrowing, the concrete is still us, but from the point of view of the industry, it was not. The industry basically, and again, I'm recorded, so I'm happy to say, initially the concrete industry in New Zealand was not happy because they said, you are in the New Zealand Concrete Society Management Committee. You are supposed to be pushing for concrete. Say, no, you don't understand. I'm a researcher. I'm a freelancer in that point of view. I can marry any material that I want. I can dismarry. I can change my mind with any material. I am not committed to any material. I'm committed with technology, which is a different thing. So we only after we explain that moving from concrete to timber, you see here, beam column joint, timber, LVL, 4.5% of drift. We are not able to break. These are the external plug and play dissipator. On the bottom side, you see the column going back and forth, 5% of drift, 8% of drift. We couldn't break it. There are benefits of using timber when compared to concrete in many sense and negatives. One of the negatives is stiffness. You see the flex shape on the bottom? When we show that flex shape in a paper, the reviewer said, good comments, and they said, please, could you change the figure 15, whatever it was, because that figure is the numerical model. You need to show the experimental test. And you say, no, this is the experimental test. So it was too nice, too pure. There's no stiffness reduction, because if you don't have bond breakage and you're using rocking only, there is no stiffness reduction. So basically, we are going back to a system technology-wise, which is not stiffness degrading. You're not using bond in concrete. You're not using bond in timber. We did actually, just to explain you, we use, I don't have the time here, we developed starting from internal mild steel. So we use in timber, mild steel, not threaded bars like used they were using timber, but concrete type of deformed bars with epoxy resins instead of, mortar. And we were just testing internal mild steel, and then we externally use the plug and play. So not happy, we keep going, beam column joint, walls, single walls, double walls, beam column joint with flooring system, post tension long span beams. And then we go for a big mock-up, big specimen in the lab. This big specimen is made of post tension frames in one direction, you can see here, and the plug and play were there, and post-tension walls in the other direction, couple. So the idea is really to try to mix walls with frames because walls are very strong and powerful and stiff, and frames gives you the open space. So this is the lab test. And in a few minutes, I have to finish. If it goes, no, it should go. Hold on a second. No, there's something wrong. I need to go out and it's quite strange. This is a test on bidirectional loading where we were pushing under X quasi-static, increasing drift, Y, and then clover leaf. So we were going and going and going. We couldn't break it. So you see here that the height of the column is higher than the beam. Reason being that this is a 2/3 scale, but we had a wish, which was a trust. We said we are probably not going to break it. We are going to damage dissipators and replace them, but hopefully we are going to maintain the skeleton okay. So if that is the case, we were already thinking about taking the building out of the lab, putting that somewhere else as a showroom. So the matter was, who's going to buy it or take it, and who's going to put it where? We didn't want to send it to the West Coast. Some people asked to get it as a house in the West Coast. We said we want to keep it in Christchurch, and we managed to convince the University of Canterbury to place in a yard. This yard is now being used for the amazing new laboratory, which was part of the idea since a while, but it was not yet planned where to go and where not to go. We had to wait, unfortunately, for the earthquake to have the justification of constructing a new lab. So the building is being demounted as part of the sustainability concept. I construct and I demount just by disconnecting the elements, and I remount it later. And this has been then fully finished when the earthquake came. Just to confirm that what happens was really a sort of an avalanche, positive avalanche into the direction of awareness. This is a TV commercial on the, let me see if I, tell me if you can hear it on television.
Yeah, we can hear it.
Okay. So obviously it's a bit complicated from if you are not familiar with the accent. This actor is from the islands, but he's pretending to be from an island where he's not from, and this is quite a big deal from his point of view. So he's wearing a shirt which is not belonging to his island, but and he's explaining. Try to see it, then I will tell you.
How you follow? Engineer said, place this big, you gotta have steel. He said, steel? That's not sound wood. We want wood, but it has to be strong, like steel. Strong, eh? And earthquake proof. Fire resistant.
That's a boss.
And it had to look good too. Awesome, folly, eh? Wood.
No, excuse me. Just a finishing.
Alnuke.co.nz at nth degree. Look now with a digital, cultural, wood, traditional, spiritual, cultural, and now with a university degree. Learn about it at nzwood.co.nz.
Okay, so interestingly, the probably translation helped. Is this actor is saying our new fale. The fale is that building which has a very important family social type of environment. We would like to have it in wood. The engineer said, wood, you cannot do it in wood, it's too big, you need to make it in steel. And the actor says, steel is not a Samoan, it's not from the island of Samoan material, we want to have wood, but it needs to be so. Just to clarify, that has been a beautiful experience because we got the crew from television coming to the lab.
Steel. That's not Samoan. We want wood.
Hold on a second. Where we were testing full scale now, there you are. This is a full scale beam column connection, interior beam column, and it's the PhD thesis of a Zifik Ball. So we were already doing this testing because we were already almost ready to go for a real building. And in the lab, we keep going. We are doing also shaking table tests. So hold on a second, if you keep going. I stop it. It's getting in trouble, restart the program. So basically, we're doing shaking table tests as part of the research. So we make a shorter version of that shaking table test to explain what it looked like, okay? But to do that, we had to interrupt the laboratory testing for one day. And you think it's nothing. It was a huge deal because we were really testing 5 to 6 to 7 setup at the same time. And having for one day everything stopped, it was definitely a major issue. Let me just check if I can again, okay? Hold on a second. Try. There you are. So just to do that, hey, which is a very typical Kiwi, but also somehow an Australian way of ending a sentence. This guy took, 100 times he did. He's strong, hey, strong, hey. Kept going and changing everything. So it was a lot of fun to see how much does it take to have only 30 seconds of a commercial? But this commercial goes on television. Everyone is knowing about that. Everyone is asking what it is, how does it work, how can I do it? They go to their own architects. They always go first to the architect, after to the engineer. And the architect says, don't know what you're talking about. Or if it's honest, if it's he, she's honest. Or, of course, I'm familiar with that. Just ask to the engineer to design it, and I would be very happy. So the double reaction is either pretending to know, otherwise it would be embarrassing, or because it's your client asking, or saying that you don't know, but you're going to basically get updated. And here we start receiving requests from the market saying, can you give us a short course? Because our clients is asking, so it's the push and pull, is the society asking, and we are pre-earthquake. So for today is enough, because the next step is about talking, we are going to move from the skeleton to the structural system, from the structural system to the floor. And then we are going to talk about the non-structural elements. And then I want to show you real buildings, either in concrete or in timber. So today we have done really a big push. Also, stop share. There we are. I have a couple of videos that I want to show you, a couple of videos. One of the testing in San Diego, because it was a big, big test. A five-story building tested in the lab was the largest at that time test carried in the United States. So I want you what it looks like. I want you to see what it looks like so that you don't think that it was a matter of doing some big column joint testing. It was really the big, big, test. And then I want to finish off on Friday showing what we were missing. We managed to do it, a 3D shaking table test, including vertical acceleration of this skeleton plus the dress, including interior reinforced masonry building, reinforced masonry infill, as well as fiberglass type of partitions, as well as exterior concrete facade, glazing facades, and everything else. So this will be the end, and I will be giving you links to YouTube where you can find quite some materials that we've been preparing for that. Okay, we are at 11, so I'm happy with what we covered. It's quite intense, I know it. I hope that the translation has been helping a bit to follow my speed in broken English. But don't worry, you're going to have in the materials, you will find some of the narratives. So the one that can be written in a paper, not the one that says about the anecdotic type of things. The one that can be written in a paper, you will find them in the papers. Questions, curiosity from some of you?
Stefano, two things. One, what time is the course, the session on Friday? 8, 8.30, oh, okay. 10?
So if you agree, I think you would, Arsalan.
I'm happy either, yeah.
I think we can do, let me see how many people we have today. No, it didn't change. It's interesting. First of all, I need you to explain to, if you know people who registered, but are not participating, because there are 100 people registered and only 33 here participating. That's not what we wanted to do. We wanted to have 120 people registering, 100 participating, because the other got in trouble for working reason, okay? So first of all, please spread the word around saying in a nice way, you at least need to commit on the last day. Otherwise, Stefano, you can use a PH. You can use PH with a big PH. It's Stefano with the F. But Stefano is not very keen to send you a free ride if you didn't, if you slept comfortably during those evening. Or so make sure that if you have connection, don't use LinkedIn for that, Arsalan. But if someone is asking, so is that going to be recorded? Only if you're going to receive a link, only if you come and participate. They will say, but what I missed the first two things. So your suggestion can be think a nice cultural donation that you can do because you missed the first two ones. And then, I don't know, people can be free or think about their own cultural donation, which means it basically is going into schools and explaining earthquake engineering to someone, talking to your friends on a Friday evening with a beer in front of you at the pub, but insisting to explain earthquake-proof buildings, and they will be thinking, shut up, and you insist, because otherwise you don't get the link. So this type of thing. Not letting your client get out of your room if you're designing something for that client until they see a couple of videos about low damage. And then until they ask, how much does it cost? That's the question. Let them ask how much does it cost. They should say, I don't care. But if they ask how much does it cost, they are ready to think about it, okay? Otherwise means they can't really less, and it's complicated. So, yeah. So I would be saying, yes, let's do it 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. New Zealand, Italian time, on Friday too. We are going to send you, let me see if Andrea Arena, Dr. Arena, are you still here? Andrea, ci sei? Because he had another commitment. So if not, I will arrange for the PhD doctoral program to send you a calendar change to all of you who have been registering the email. But in any case, this is the same link. So we are going to reconvene on Friday at 8 a.m. New Zealand, Italian time. Keep saying New Zealand, 8 a.m. Italian time. Okay.
Thank Stefano, you. That would be good if they can fix the email to match 8 to 10 as well. Because in the email, it was saying 10. I checked with Nico. She thought that today is 10 to 1. So that's why.
Yeah, having said that, I didn't see people jumping in at 10 a.m.
Yeah.
So the number of people have been basically the same. So we were probably.
That's true. That's true.
So, yeah. So those people cannot use it as an excuse. They say, you didn't show up.
Yeah.
You see? Yeah. So tell them off. Yeah. So either way, they're going to be told off, which is in a good sense, obviously, in a nice way. Any other question or curiosity?
I have one, but no time. Next Friday.
You ask the question and answer next time.
Yes. Oh, ask the question. Why the market liked the PressLam more than press technology? We have more and more PressLam every months in New Zealand, not as much the concrete one.
Okay, I add something to your question. Why the New Zealand?
Yeah, in New Zealand, yes.
Because it's not the market around the world. And the reality, unfortunately, for you guys is something that you know, is the same reality. The buildings in Christchurch got destroyed, are reinforced masonry, not retrofitted, or heavily damaged reinforced concrete. Victims happen by two buildings, a five-story reinforced concrete. You don't have enough time to explain, or people don't want to listen, that it was a matter of knowledge of detailing. How many steel buildings were in Christchurch? Very few. C1 tower was brand new and it got repaired with a lot of intense cost. But the perception was masonry kills, concrete cannot be repaired. Still, so the way of not understanding of people is incredible. How many buildings, what is the percentage of and the age of the buildings? And just people don't care. So there was basically a swing into ductile material, steel. And so this swing has been exacerbated by the possibility of doing prefabrication in steel. This has been, I think, a lack of opportunity from the precast concrete industry in New Zealand. They could have installed plants, precast plants in Christchurch, and they would have been able to serve and supply a lot of precasting in-house instead of buying steel from out. So there's a prejudice about the material, which is the same mistake done in the past. Then, having done that prejudice, then low damage has been used in all steel or concrete bases or latest structure regardless. So the low damage is not a novelty. Timber ticks a lot of other points from a sustainability point of view, from an environmental point of view. And honestly, because of that, some people are in love with timber no matter what. Okay, in New Zealand, they are living in a timber house, so they love the idea to be able to have it. Once they understand that timber can do the same thing that other material can do, then option one, I like it because I like timber. Option two, sustainability is fashion. Sustainability is pushing also the New Zealand government to go in a certain direction. And we were discussing that at Salam. that is basically suggesting not to demolish and reconstruct if you can repair. So low damage allows you not to repair too much, not to spend too much. Timber allows you to construct with very small cranes and to be in the sustainability environment. So it makes sense. Having said that, why not? And that's the point of this course. The title is Concrete and Timber, but I will be showing also steel buildings, Forte Health in Christchurch, being part of that. And is an example that you can do in any material prior to the earthquake, or it was already conceived. Forte Health is a post-earthquake design, okay? But the concept itself can be used for any material, including reinforced masonry. So the question, Arsalan, that you're posing is, I will be rephrasing, why people are not aware that the bar can be and has been raised for any material, including concrete timber, steel concrete, steel timber, steel concrete timber base isolated, steel concrete timber base isolated with the dissipative braces and viscous dampers. So and I'm going to show you at least some thermal courts where we have concrete timber post tension with drape tenons, steel concrete comp floor is a composite flooring system. So we are really having the three materials base isolated. So already done and dusted. So it is possible, it's a matter of awareness. The designers, the engineers in New Zealand now can literally manage any material, literally, from any technology point of view. They can do pushover, thermistry, whatever else. So it's a matter of what they are more familiar with in terms of design. And so I'm surprised that there are not enough concrete press, but I will be showing you a few slides of what we presented at the World Conference in Earthquake Engineering, Japan, in Sendai. It was online. It was blended, but we present from online. And we presented the Turanga Library, the central library in Christchurch, which is fantastic, and is using press walls as a core element, a three-dimensional core elements with a detail of how to decouple them and couple them back using U-shaped flexural plate for a 3D core wall that we tested in the lab. So that's one of the best, more iconic building out of the, what we call the anchor projects as part of the reconstruction of the city that has been using that. So then the other question is, Arsalan, the question comes back. When is the last time that you saw a publicity on television like the one that I show you? For some reason, people stopped, including the government. They said the market is aware of it, but that's not true. You have to keep telling the story, keep pushing, put an incentive. Give me, a fast track in the building consent if you go for that. So the concept that people know and so they will be doing, people know and they forget. And so I saw, again, I'm a recorder. I saw all type of concrete frames using casting C2 plastic hinge, which is going to create beam elongation, being constructed. It should not happen. After what we've seen in Kaikoura earthquake, with the problems on precast floors due to the plastic hinge beam elongation, not due to the precast then either people should be using a different detailing in the precast flooring, or they should be using a different detailing. It's going to be part of the next class, the next seminar on Friday. Different detailing on the frame, or they do something else. So my concern is that after a while, people will be going back to something old. I don't think it's going to happen to New Zealand because the designer in New Zealand already so familiar, so used to thinking a different way that they will not accept to go back. But to explain for other people, because the market is a booming market, the booming market is accepting a new company to born from one day to the other. I finish my degree, I open up an office. And so I don't belong to that basically raising up culture that has occurred because I was not there in the earthquake. I did not work for 10 years in a big company in the country. So I just opened up my market. And in my new market, I will get jobs because there's a need for engineers, unfortunately. So the quality can quality control can be compromised as soon as you and the raising up the bar can be compromised. So on that, I will be urging, suggesting that the government can place a premium, saying your client, and so you as a technical designer, should be receiving a premium in any form if you go above the minimum by law bar. And so at that point, you can bet that the engineer will not be able to do the old things.
Yeah.
And it's one of the few cases when we say that the old things are not anymore good. Because one thing is to say the old way of designing, which is absolutely still brilliant and calculation, but the old things means the old technology, and you will never buy a computer of the 1980. As simple as. So you will never buy, and I will explain to you that the Nokia 30, Nokia non-smartphone phone, unless you want to give it to your kids to be sure that they are not able to access internet for safety. So only in that case you'll be doing. So I will be explaining that in a slide at the end. So thanks everyone for connecting. I will be looking forward to see you in 2 days' time, 8 a.m. again, and talk to you soon. Okay?
Yes.
And there's still plenty to cover. I will be finishing off telling you, I'll tell you already at the end of Friday that I couldn't tell you, I couldn't show you, I couldn't, but then you have again a starting point for going and finding information, because it's easy now to find things.
Absolutely.
Fantastic. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks.